Today's date is November 12, 1997. The survivor's name is Maurice Gordon. My name is Dan Danielli. And the interview is conducted in Albany, New York, USA, in the English language. My name is Dan Danielli. That's D-A-N-I-E-L-I. Today's date is November 12, 1997. Survivor's name is Maurice Gordon, and the interview is conducted in Albany, New York, USA, in the English language. What is your name, please?
My name is Maurice Gordon.
When you were born, was it the same name?
My born Jewish name was Moshe Gordon.
And would you spell Gordon, please?
G-O-R-D-O-N.
Did you use any other names during the war? Or after the war?
Well, they called me in Polish Misha. Okay. My Hebrew name was Moshe.
Any Jewish nickname?
No.
What is your date of birth?
I was born March the 5th, 1933.
Which would bring you to what age today?
I'm 64.
And where were you born?
I was born in a small village or town in that's called Ostrowiec in Poland.
Could you spell Ostrowiec, please?
O-S-T-R-O-W-I-E-C.
In which area of Poland is that town?
Well, this is in the vicinity, or I would say is approximately 50 kilometers from Vilnius, which was the big city in that part of Poland at that time.
Do you remember Ostrowiec?
Yes, I remember it quite well.
How long did you stay in Ostrowiec as a child?
From the time I was born until 1943. And then I came back to Ostrowiec in July 1944.
What was your father's name?
My father's name was Samuel Gordon.
And your mother's?
Ite Fege Gordon.
Did you have any siblings?
No.
What did your father do for a living?
My father was a baker, and so was my mother. They both worked together.
Was the bakery at home?
Yes.
What kind of a house did you live in?
Well, the homes in that village, all of the homes were built out of logs, like a log cabin. And it was very simple, very primitive. The roof was made out of straw, like a thatched roof. And insulation was in the attic with sand, a great deal of sand, that was the insulation. And there was no running water. There was no electricity. It was heated by wood with a stove that was built out of bricks. You'd heat up the bricks to a point where it would radiate heat into the house and just move about and keep it warm that way.
Could you lay out verbally the house from the inside, including the bakery?
Yes, it would be.
Would you do that?
I remember it, yes. It was a small house, okay. The front of the house would open up, the doors would open up to the street. This town, Ostrowiec, had one street that was going right through Ostrowiec, and the houses were on both sides of the street. So my father's bakery, the front of the house was a room where they would sell the product that they would make, the baked goods. In between the store, and there was a partition, and there was a small room, which was the dining room. It's a very small room. It was a table, a few chairs. And then to the left, there was another partition, sort of, and there was a bedroom with two beds. In one bed, my father and mother slept. In the other bed, I slept. And the beds were sort of head-to-head, like this here. And the heat in that house that we would get in the wintertime, which was cold, was from the oven that my father used to bake the bread. It would radiate a lot of heat, and I was always warm. Okay. And then there was the bakery itself that had all this huge wooden troughs where they would create the dough, you know, and everything was done manually with their hands. There was no electricity, there were no mixing machines, nothing. And there was another room that they kept the flour and so forth, like a storage room. And so that was mainly the layout of the house. It was very small, very cramped. That was the layout of the house, yes. As far as if you had to go out to the bathroom, you would have to go out of the house and walk some distance behind a barn. Usually it was always behind a barn. And there was outhouse there. And that is where you went for your, that was a facility there. Yeah.
Did your father have employees?
No, my mother and father, they both worked at and baked. I can go and tell you the process of how it was, how their daily life was conducted, how their labors were. To me, it was very interesting. And I remember because I grew up in it. I was born in it. It wasn't like here now in the United States, where everything is done. You turn on a switch and everything, a machine mixes it up, you know, and you turn on the faucet and you get water, you get hot water and you get cold water. You buy flour, you know, you buy different grades of flour. You buy salt and butter and whatever you need, milk. Everything is there. You turn on a switch and the oven heats up. There it was everything done manually by labor. My father had to buy from the farmers, from the peasants, from the Christians. Some of them had forests, okay. So they would cut down the woods and they would sell the lumber, you know, the logs. And my father would have to go every Monday, there would be a market in that town. And the peasants would come from all around the surrounding areas and they would bring the product, whether it was wood, whether it was potatoes, whether it was wheat, whether it was chickens or pigs or whatever, they had wool to sell, butter or to sell, to trade with, okay. And by doing so, they would get money, and then they would go and buy other things that they needed, whatever they needed, okay. So that was a time when my father would go, and he would contract with a person that was selling wood, and so many cords of wood, and he would deliver it to my father in log form. And my father would have to cut the logs into small, maybe like 2.5 feet, 30 inches long. And he would have to split it then and season it because he couldn't use it. It was wet. So every year he was using wood that was already prepared a year ago, okay? And it was replenishing itself. So that was very hard work. The same thing was with getting flour. He would have to buy the wheat. There was a mill that was driven by water turbine. There was a river going through there. And I would go with him many times by horse and wagon. He would buy wheat. We would go there, and we would process the wheat into different grades of flour to produce different products. And so that was how he obtained the means by which he could produce the bread and the pastries and so forth. And water was, there was a well right outside the house, quite a deep well. You would have to lower a bucket with a rope and then bring it up and just carry it into the house and warm it up when you needed hot water, or when cold water was easy. But when hot water, you had to warm it up. And every morning, my father and mother would get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. And the evening before, they would prepare certain doughs, you know, for sour bread, and there was different kind of preparation for it. So when you get up 3 o'clock in the morning, it was already ready. It was ready to be worked at, you know, and make the breads and the pastries and so forth. And before that, he would fire up the oven and bring it up to a certain temperature. There was no thermometer that you looked at the thermometer, oh, it's okay now. It was just by testing it, by coming close to the flame or putting the hand out of and just feeling the intensity of the heat. and by that means he would know when the oven was ready to be used for baking. And then they would prepare the product, the breads and the pastries, like I said, and put it in the oven. And everything was timed by experience. Okay. He knew just by looking at it, just by moving it around with that wooden shovel, you know, on a long handle, and just by picking it up, whether the bread was ready, and take it out. And that was very, very hard work. Not only was it hard work, it was very difficult because it was in the summertime, it was so hot, just from the heat from the oven alone. And I'm not talking about all the other labors that was so intense. And my mother worked with him hand by hand, just right next to him doing all that hard work. And then around 8 o'clock, it was all timed on a cycle. They knew exactly when to start what and how. About 8 o'clock in the morning, they would open up the doors to the street, hoping to get customers to buy the fresh bread or the fresh pastries. And depending on the day, they knew approximately how much to bake, you see. There wasn't much that would be left over for spoil, because that would be a ruination. It wouldn't be right. They would just lose. There wouldn't be any profit to it. So they knew approximately how much to bake. And whatever was left over, it was given away to friends or relatives. We had, my grandmother was there, and my mother's brothers and sisters. So we had family. We'd just give it to them. Or people that would come in, or poor people, didn't have any money, we would give it to them what's left, instead of having it ghost tail on, or never, nothing was thrown out. So they had an idea how much to bake. And this was the type of life that they were doing, day after day, without an end. The only time that they would have a day off was from Friday after sunset until Saturday after sunset. That was their day of rest. That is when my father would take me Friday evening, and we would go to the synagogue, to the shul, as it was called, and we would then come back home, and my mother would already have had the evening meal prepared, and of course she would have the candles, the Shabbat candles on, and she would bench, as they call it, you know, make a prayer over the Shabbat candles, and we would have our Shabbat evening, Friday night Shabbat meal, okay. Now, before I continue, I would like to sort of give you an idea, a flavor of the Jewish community in that town of Strogitz. I was a little boy at that time, and I remember things very well. God, I probably remember things since I was 3.5 or 4 years old. Certain things stand out in my mind. It's like it happened today, because it made a great impression upon me then, and I have it with me. It's so fresh and so alive. I could close my eyes and visualize the people and the houses. It was in the summertime. I was running around barefoot, you know, and I knew if somebody coughed in one house, I knew exactly who the person was that coughed, what his name was, you know. It was so close. It was such a small community. Everybody knew everybody, and everybody helped everybody. So the Jewish community in that town, they organized themselves for the benefit of themselves, okay? In other words, some of the elders were elected sort of to be like, well, the elders of the community. They took charge, you know, for the benefit of the community. And the Jews that were a little better off than the other ones would donate money to this officer, and they would keep like a little a place where other unfortunate Jews that needed medicine, that needed clothes, that needed to pay some certain bills that was necessary to pay. They would come and they would apply to this office and tell their troubles, and they would get a loan, okay. Not a big loan, but, you know, within reason, whatever was possible to help them. That loan was given to them without any interest, and they could pay as often as it was possible for them, as much or as little as it was possible for them, or sometimes they didn't have to repay it at all. If they couldn't, it was just forgotten, written off, and that's all. If I remember correctly, this office was called Milat Chesed, which is a Hebrew word. I think it has to do with a deal of passion or understanding, or Chesed means goodness, something like that, okay? And this was, the Jewish communities basically took care of themselves. They also had their own court. The court was there because the Jews could not, in that community, under the Polish, because we were guests in Poland, okay? The Jews, if they had some kind of disagreement with one another in our community, they would not apply to the justice of the peace, to the Christian justice of the peace, because if they were brought before the Christian justice of the peace, they would be mocked upon and made fun upon, okay? And they would be just ridiculous. And so if there was a disagreement, there were the elders of the town, the Jews, including the rabbi, and they would sit down, and they would discuss the problem, and they would come to this arbitrary decision, you know. Pardon me, it was like it was given to arbitration, okay? And whatever the verdict was, then the person tried to fulfill it. I mean, it was nothing like killing anybody. There was no such thing as killing or stealing. Those were just grievances somebody says about somebody and all this stuff. You know, you borrowed something and maybe you didn't return it as fast as you could and so forth. There were minor things. There was no major criminals among the Jewish community in our town that I know of. Everybody was like the same as like everybody else. Maybe somebody was a little bit better off, but generally they were about on the same level. It was a very, very hard and difficult life for everybody. Everybody worked just to exist, just to have food, not fancy food, but basic foods, and clothes, and be able to have a place to live. Most of the Jews in that community had their own cow, because the cow gave them milk, it gave them yogurt, it gave them cheese, it gave them butter, and that was a great luxury to have a cow. I mean, you had a cow, you were something, you were good off. They also had their own chickens, so they had eggs. And of course, if the flock increased, they would also have chicken for Shabbos and so forth. You know, it was. It reminds me. It, in a sense, you know, I remember going, and I saw the musical, The Fiddler on the Roof, Anatevka. Anatevka is so similar to the life of Ostrovets, to the life of the Jews in Ostrovets. It is amazing. When I saw the play, I couldn't get over the similarities, the characters in that play. It's the same like in Ostrovets among the Jews. They had all these stories, you know, with marriages and sort of one Jew had animosities about another towards another Jew because of some kind of, he promised him a chicken and gave him something else or whatever it is. I mean, there were such funny, funny stories that brought everything to life for me when I saw The Fiddler on the Roof, you know. Those characters, they were so similar. You could write the same story about my town. So it was, in a way, I remember it as sort of it was like a happy town. You know, everybody knew everybody. We got along with each other. We helped one another. I'm talking about the Jewish community. When I was a little boy, I had Jewish friends and I had Christian friends. We just ran around in the summertime, barefoot, playing games, sort of silly games, whatever games we decided to play. We were sort of having a good time. I remember as a child, the first time in that town that I, as a child, have confronted insults that were said towards me by my Christian friends. Little boys, mostly boys. The girls sort of didn't hang around with us. And we used to play, and when the game went along fine, to their favor, then everything was good. But if the game didn't go along fine to the Christian favor, you know, in that particular game, then I was a Jew. I was a Jid. I was a Christ killer. I was called Jid Parach Nidaroda Moya Dupa Tvoya Broda. It's a derogatory term. It means that, look at you, your head is full of kind of pussy cysts, you know. You're this ugly human being. You haven't quite been born yet. Your beard and my ass are the same, you know. It was said to me over and over again. It's like a repeating song, you know. And I didn't know what they were really talking about, why they were so hateful towards me. And I didn't do much about it anyway. You know, I didn't come home running and say, so-and-so had called me, I'm a Jew killer, or I'm a Christ killer, okay, and called me names. And I remember one time we played, it was a rain, we played in the gutter. On both sides of the street there was a gutter running, and the water that was ran off through the gutter went into the river. There was a river, so it was pitched that way. And the crown of the street, you know, water was running off. And we were playing in the gutter, and there were rocks in the gutter that were put in from erosion, okay? So this little Christian boy, he ran in the gutter. We were running around barefoot, and he fell. He tripped, and he hit his head on a stone that had a sharp edge protruding. And he had a pretty good cut. He was bleeding, you know, the blood was just coming out, and he was probably scared as hell. So he ran home crying, and all of a sudden, not long after, his mother and father came to my mother and father and accused and said that I pushed him, okay, and I was the cause of his injury. And my father said, is that true? He said, no, I didn't do it, you know. And at that time, I didn't understand it. But anyway, my mother and my mother's sister, the younger sister, came over to this Christian family that a little boy was injured. And they said that they feel terribly sorry that I was the cause of his injury, and that if there's anything they could do, they would like to make him feel better. If there's anything they could give them, you know, that they would be very happy to do that, and they're sorry about it. So I learned then, I knew then, but I didn't understand. I didn't understand, you see. I just knew that something is wrong, that I'm being unjustly punished for something I never did or accused of. But I didn't have the mental capacity, the intellect to figure it out. So it was running around in my computer, you know, for many, many years. And later on, it started to come out. And I started to reason, ask questions, why did that happen? And, of course, I came out, I was reasoning I reasoned it out that if in this particular instance, if he came home and he said, well, I was negligent, I didn't pay attention, I fell and I hurt myself. So usually the culture there is if you hurt yourself, the father would give you another licking because you were so negligent and so stupid, and that really it was an accident, he didn't understand, but he beat you more, okay? So in order to avoid another beating on top of his injury, he said that a Jew pushed him, and that made it beautiful, that made it fine, because the Jew was always the devil. The Jew always was responsible for everything that was evil. I reasoned this out later on. At that time, I was not aware of that. I didn't have, like I said, the intellect to figure it out. Okay. So there was incidents like this here. Now, I also remember that during the time of the market, which was Monday, that when all the peasants would come and bring their goods, there was a lot of commerce going on. And my father's house, my father's store was open, you know, to customers. That there was a group of Polish people, they called themselves Narodowcy. That comes from the word Narod, which means nationalist, okay? They were nationalist. They used to stand in front of my father's store and also in front of other Jewish stores. There was another baker Jew. There was a glazier, which didn't have a store. There was a person that would deal in material. He needed to buy a piece of material. Maybe he had it, and he would go and buy it from him. And there was a hardware store person that would deal in hardware store, okay? Otherwise, the rest of the Jews were just sort of like peasants also. They would buy they would buy things here, like traveling salesmen, some of them, and go to another town and sell and try to make a living. But coming back to these Norodovtsi, they would stand in front of the door on Monday, and they would admonish, they would say to the Christians, now look, this is a Jewish Torah. Why do you have to go and trade with the Jews? Why don't you go and trade with the Christians, with your own kind? Okay. Now, we used to sit on the stoop. There was a little stoop to get up under the first, on the level of the floor, outside, and just looking and listening. And I absorbed it all. And as I say, later on, I was questioning it all and wondering why. And, pardon me. Now, Now I'm telling you the story of this little town of Strovitz. And this story probably could be told in hundreds of other little towns because they're all similar. Because the life in that part of Poland was all similar. It was another Anatevka. Okay? So later on I started to notice that when I would walk in the street, they would spit at me, spit at me and call me, you dirty Jew, And they would say, Christ killer. And I really never gave it much thought. It's just it was registering in my mind. Of course, after giving it a lot of thought later on, I came to certain conclusions, which one has to be blind not to realize is where they got it. I mean, they didn't get it out of the thin air, they got it because most of those people, those peasants, those, I'll call them Gentiles, okay, but they weren't very gentle, they got their education. They got all their knowledge. They weren't worldly. They didn't have any Weltanschauung or anything like this here. They just had very tunnel vision, and whatever they were told by the authorities, and the authority in that pound, in those towns at that time was the church. The church was supreme. And when they went to church and they were talking about the gospel, and when they came to the time of Christ, and when they came to the crucifixion, and when they said that Christ was crucified and the Jews helped crucifying Christ, they took it literally. They had no education. They had no history. They had no world outlook. They didn't understand. It wasn't made to them clear in what context they're talking about. And they took it literally. And when they went out and they saw a Jew, they said, here is the Christ killer. Here is the killer of my Lord, And for that, we were hated. And I am talking now as a man that has spent many, many years trying to figure out. And I came to such a conclusion now.
We will stop now and go to the next tape.
Okay. Am I talking?
This is tape number 2. I'm interviewing Mr. Morris Gordon. You were explaining about your town, your hometown. Yes. How big was the town as per number of families?
Yeah, well, I couldn't tell you exactly the number of families. I calculated, you see, it's like I told you, when I was a little boy, I knew all the Jewish homes. I also knew most of the Christian homes because it was a small town. It was, like I said, one street and homes and houses on both sides. So I was familiar. But I concentrated, I imagined walking through the town some time ago, I did it, and I counted every Jewish house, how many people there lived, how many Jewish souls there were, okay? From house to house, from family to family. Now, I don't remember, most of the names I do not remember, but I could see their faces, okay? I remember some names. I could see their faces, and I remember the children and the fathers and the mothers and the uncles and the aunts and the grandfathers, the grandparents. And I came up with a number, plus or minus, of 120 Jews in this community. And I figured this was about a quarter, 25% of the whole town, which means that the other 75% were Gentiles.
What was the occupation of the rest of your family in the town?
Well, in the town, which was just across the street almost, my grandmother lived there, and her daughter, which is my mother's younger sister, and her son, which is my mother's younger brother.
Would you mention names?
Yes. The daughter was named Dverele, which is Dora, and my uncle was named Benjamin. Okay.
And the grandmother?
My grandmother was named Nachamizelde. And her husband died in the First World War, so she was a widow. Okay. Anyway, my uncle would deal in. He was usually buying stuff and selling stuff. He would buy a cow on a marketplace. He would take it to another place and sell it, or a horse. Okay, or sometimes he would contract with some wealthy, they were called Pani. Pan is a wealthy landowner that had an apple orchard, okay, an orchard of apples. He would contract, he would buy the apple orchard from him. And he would, when the apples were ready to be picked, he would pick the apples and take them to Vilnius and sell them there. Now, if the year was favorable and there was a good crop, then he made a profit, but if it was a bad year, he took a loss. So it was a gamble, you see. He would do things like that. Otherwise, the girls sort of hung around in the house and helped the mother. There were so many chores to be done, but he was basically the bread provider for my grandmother, for his sister and my grandmother. That was my uncle, Benjamin. Yeah, yeah. And other Jews did similar things, sort of like that. You see, they didn't have any land. They couldn't farm any land. They couldn't grow any crops. They just had a little garden for their own kitchen, like, you know, what you grow, salads and radishes and little potatoes. But no wheat. No, they didn't have any, like, 5-6 cows. They didn't have, plows. They didn't have any land to plow. It was not given to them. The land was distributed by the Polish government to the Polish people. There's so many hectares or acres of land to this one, so many to this one, to this, and so forth, but nothing to the Jews.
Let's go back for a moment to the bakery.
Yes.
As a small child, did you help out in the bakery?
I beg your pardon?
Did you help out in the bakery?
Oh, no. I did not help out. The only time I helped out my father is when he was cutting the wood. So sometimes he wanted to make me feel, because I was anxious to help, he wanted to make me feel like a big man. He would ask me to help him, okay, to stack the wood, you know, and so forth. But otherwise, no, I did not help. I was just a little boy, you know.
Did the neighbors bring to your bakery on Friday any food to be stored for
yes.
Saturday?
Yes, yes. My father would have his oven prepared for chont. You remember chont? Chont is... It's a dish. I mean, if you're Jewish, you know what chont is, okay? And they would bring it in, and he would keep it for them till Saturday when they would come from the synagogue, and everyone would come, whoever availed themselves of that oven, and take it out and take it home, and they would eat it. Yes, yeah.
Was there any kosher supervision of the bakery? Did the rabbis or somebody come?
The bakery, I don't know if it was or not, but it was kosher as far as I know, because it was a matter of water, it was a matter of yeast and salt and wheat, and I would think yes, it was kosher, but anybody could buy it. The Jews and the Gentiles availed themselves of the product. I would say yes, it was kosher.
Do you remember any holiday ceremonies at home, Passover or New Year?
Well, mostly I remember a Passover because that was a great occasion. You know, that is when my father, I mean, that was a big deal. I mean, all the people in the village, not all, but a lot of people, women and men, would come. And the matzahs were baked, you know, from the very scratch. You would roll it out, you know, and then you would have a little wheel that they would perforate it, you know, so forth. And my father would bake the matzahs, excuse me, for the whole community, okay? So that was a great deal of commotion, a great deal of sort of, it was a communal thing, and they were happy about it. And it was very festive. And they would burn the chometz, you know, for the Passover. And it was a great deal. Passover was a great deal, okay? It was very festive because it was a holiday that didn't have just one evening and it was over. It was a whole week, you know, stuff like this. This was very important holiday and it was very festive. And I remember.
Do you remember the holiday table, the Passover table?
I remember the holiday table. My mother had a special tablecloth that, oh my God, to me it was so rich, you know. It was very embroidered and everything. And she would use that only on Passover. Now she had, we didn't have two sets of dishes, okay? So we had to kosher dishes. What we would do is we would take a huge barrel and we would put in hot red stones and it would just boil the water and they would dip, after they washed the dishes, they would dip in it, you know, and that was being kosher, okay? So then they used dishes that were kosher for Passover. Okay, that is how. But it was special food, you know. We had a goose, you know, that they would stuff the goose to fatten it up, so it would have gribbins. The gribbins are the fat that took off from the goose, and they cooked it in with onions and with spices, and then they made gefilte. Matzah knedlach, that they use the gribbins in it, okay? Now, matzah knedlach are matzah balls, and the gribbins, which is that fat that was cooked with the onions and with the spices, gave it so much flavor. And that was eaten with a chicken soup, and that was something good. And then, of course, we had the charoises and the wine. So it was very festive, and it was very nice.
Did you have a special place at the festive table?
I used to sit next to my father, yeah, and that was that. Yes.
Did you say the Manish Tana yourself?
Yes, I asked the questions and I said the Manish Tana, and my father would reply with the answers, which I understood some of it and I didn't understand others because I was too young, but I asked the questions. Yes.
To whom did you feel closer, to your father or to your mother?
Well, I really don't know. I never asked myself the question. I would say probably both, because I miss them both. So I think both, yeah.
What religious studies did you have while you went to school before the war, when you were still very small?
Yeah. In this community, as in all the small Jewish communities, there was always a cheder. A cheder is a school. It's a cheder is a Hebrew word, and it was usually the one room. And they would hire a teacher. Okay, it was they paid him a certain sum of money, and his responsibility was to teach the boys. The boys were educated. The girls didn't go to cheder. I think it was the wrong thing to do, but anyway. So we used to learn Hebrew. We started at a very, very young age. We're all sitting on a long bench with a long table on both sides of the table on benches. A bunch of kids the breishit, you know, when he starts from the very beginning. How God created the world and, you know, all the 7 days, still Sabbath and so forth. So we started from the very beginning, line by line, in Hebrew, right at the very beginning. So there was no chance of, and it was interpreted to us, the words were interpreted to us in Jewish, and at the same time, we had to learn it. In a way, we had to learn by memory, many times by memory. After reading it over and over and over, we knew it by memory. And that is how, after many, many months of studying, we would know chapters by memory. Some of them that had a good memory and that applied themselves knew more than others, but that is how the system worked. And we learned how to write in Hebrew, or Yiddish was a byproduct. I mean, Yiddish was my mother language because that is what we spoke at home, but it was important for us to know Hebrew in order to pray. We prayed only in Hebrew. That is the schooling that we received in that community from a very, very young age, maybe 3 years old.
Did you go to Cheder every day?
Yes, I went to Cheder every day except Saturday. Saturday, I think it was Saturday and Sunday. It was a 5 day, 4 or 5 day endeavor. Yeah.
And was it before school or after school?
Well, in my case, I was too young to go to school. But when I was old enough to go to school, that was after school. Yeah.
And how many grades did you go to school in your hometown?
In my hometown, I never finished the first grade. I think it was sort of between a kindergarten and the first grade. Okay, I never finished it because that was during the Polish when we were under the Polish government. Well, it was still Poland, so I went to public school in Poland. I had to do it. I mean, I think I had to do it because I went. And then soon after, we were occupied by the Russians. So the whole system stopped, and the Russians started to teach school in Russian. There was no more Polish school. Everything was in Russian. So we had to learn a new alphabet and start all over again, which wasn't a big deal because we learned very fast. Russian and Polish, that's very similar. The only thing, the alphabet is different. So it wasn't that hard.
How did your daily life change, yours and your parents' daily life, when the Russians occupied that part of Poland?
Okay, that is a good point, because my father had his own business. You see, he developed his own, he was his own boss. He worked hard, he took his risks, but he was his own boss. Nobody told him what to do. When the Russians came, they abolished any kind of commerce. You work for the state. They told you what to do, how much to bake. They gave you the flour. They told you the mixture, the proportions. They practically dictated every step that you took in your business, in your profession, what to do. And my father hated it. My father did not like the communist system. He said, I worked all these years. For what? So they would come and tell and take away my livelihood and tell me how to bake, and then they would come and take the bread, and they would give him like a salary, you know, this is what you deserve. And he didn't like that. He was very much, he was very bitter against, like, about that. But there was nothing you could do about it, because if you opened up your mouth, Siberia was the next station, okay? They would take you quietly, and you were gone. So that was, there was no choice. That was the system that they used as far as commerce, business go. There was no business. There was no independent business. You work for the state. Now, as far as the Russian occupation itself, we had no problem with them. They didn't bother you because most of the Jews were just peasants, really peasants too, okay? They didn't have very much or nothing. So we were left alone. At that time, the anti-Semitism was sort of quieted down. It's like it went under the surface, okay? But it was there. Now, I personally had Russian friends because when the Russians came, they brought their teachers with them. And when I went to the first grade, a transfer from the first grade in the Polish school to the Russian school, I had a Russian teacher. I remember her name. It's funny that I remember her name. And I could see her right now. Her name was Tatiana Pavlovna. She was very beautiful. She was tall. She had dark eyes and brown, long hair, and she was very kind to me. And we got along fine. I used to play with her, two sons. I used to play with her boys, and my mother and got along with her very, very nicely. Her husband was a colonel in the Russian army, and he was stationed there with her. And I don't recall anything that happened bad to the Jews in that community while we were occupied by the Russians from 1939 till 1941. And now, there were instances that the Russians rounded up a lot of rich people. I'm talking about landowners, and they transported them into Russia and Siberia. That was done very quietly. They just got rid of them. If you were a wealthy person, they have gotten rid of you. They resettled you. They took you out of your community and sent you to Russia, to Siberia, or whatever. And maybe some of them survived, and maybe some didn't. No, I don't know. But that was the system at that time in 1939 when we were occupied by the Russians. But I and my family and my relatives had no problem with the Russians. We got along fine. As a matter of fact, I felt much freer under the Russian occupation than I was under Polish occupation.
How was religion affected by the Russian occupation?
They left us alone. Didn't bother us. We went to synagogue. We did whatever we wanted. They didn't bother our religion. They didn't dictate to us religious beliefs, whatever it is. Of course, the Russians were atheists in those days, so it was said to them by Stalin that God is dead and so forth. And I remember a Russian officer. He stayed in my grandmother's house. They would just, assign so many soldiers to the house. He was an officer, and he used to say, "God put Pripichkom's doch." God died behind the stove, something like that. And zdoch is a derogatory term for dying. It's not like you say he died. It's just like he kind of yuck, and zdoch.
And you mentioned before that you were playing with your teacher's children.
Yes.
Do you remember any games or toys from that period of time?
We were very inventive, We had no store-bought toys. Everything was you use your imagination. It was usually a stick and a wheel, and you would sort of run around. We'd take a wire, and we would make like a U and then turn it this way. And then we'd take a wheel and we would just run along, and the force of the wire would make the wheel spin. And the faster you move, the faster it spins. Games like that would make sticks and set up a stone, and on top of the stone a little stone, and from a certain distance we would draw a line and we would pitch the sticks and see who could knock over the little stone. And while the stone was knocked over, somebody that guarded would have to replace it and guard the place, and if he poked you, then you were the loser and you would have to guard the place. It was childish, inventive games, nothing store-bought. There was no such thing as a store-bought toy or anything like this. I don't ever remember having one.
When did the Russian occupation end?
The Russian occupation ended when we were occupied by the Germans, which
when
was
that?
1941. Yeah. excuse me. I have sinus problems.
Do you remember that
yes.
when it happened?
Yes, I remember when this happened. It happened very fast. The Germans came up very fast. The Russians couldn't hold them. I remember it was gone fast, and we were occupied by the Germans.
Was there any fighting in Ostrovets?
No, there was no fighting. The Russians picked up. Apparently, they got orders to move back and to retreat. So they retreated fast, and the Germans came in. There was no fighting whatsoever in my community, in that little town.
Was there any talk with your parents that the Germans are coming, that it could happen?
Well, that is a question that I searched my mind. And to the best of my ability, I never heard my parents discuss that. Now, there was already, Warsaw was already occupied by the Germans, and the Jews were already being persecuted. But I never remember discussing or having them discuss the problems. You see, in that community, the Jews had plenty of problems of their own. They were so occupied with a daily life just to make a living, to eke out a living, that they didn't have the luxury to discuss politics. There was really no radio. The paper, I don't know how reliable it was, and I really didn't see any papers around newspapers. It was a small, now if you go to a big city, it's different. But I never heard him discuss the problem about the Germans. So I really don't know.
So the Germans arrived. How did your daily life change?
Ah, now there's a good question. When the Germans arrived, you see, the Polish people, when they were occupied by the Russians, they were always sympathizers that sympathized with the Russians. They were Polish communists because the propaganda from Russia was fantastic. They said that the communist system is the best in the world. It will be good for the workers. It will be good for the poor people. So a lot of people fell for that. And they started to sympathize with the Russians when they were occupied by Russia. And they joined their political system. They joined the Komsomolsky was a system, and also pioneers for younger boys, you know, 12, 10, 12 years old, so forth, 13. When you became older, like 16, 17 or so, you became you graduated from pioneer to Komsomol. So a lot of families sympathize with the Russians. They also became officers in that government, in that community in Ostrovets that worked with the Russians. And if they didn't like somebody, they had grudges, you know, that were perpetrated at some time to their families or whatever during the Polish government, they evened up the score. They either beat them up or they sent them to Siberia. They took away their belongings, their possessions. They just got rid of them, you know, as a punishment, as a getting even. So when the Germans occupied Poland, that particular community, and I'm speaking of my community because I lived through it, those people that were sympathetic to the Russians got written off by Polish people that became sympathetic to the Germans. You see, the thing turned around. So then whoever did them harm under the Russians, they got even again under the Germans, they got rid of those. So it was a constant cleansing, okay? But the thing about it, the awful thing about it, is that Jews were losing on both sides. Well, not under the Russians, no. But when the Germans occupied, the Jews were being persecuted to a greater extent, I mean to a degree where the Polish people in that community, they joined the Germans, they volunteered as to be policemen, they just volunteered to German to do anything that you want we'll do, okay? And they became very important, they became very powerful, they had weapons, they were given weapons. And if they didn't like you, they pointed out to the Germans, they say, well, this Jew was a communist, this young man belonged to the Komsomols, this family was sympathetic to the Russians, they were very friendly to them, you were gone, you were shot, just like that, taken out behind the town and shot. And there were instances of that happened, okay? Now, then, a short time later on, the Polish volunteers, partisans. You see, the Germans didn't know who is a Jew and who is not a Jew. They had to be pointed out by the volunteers, by the Polish police, who the Jews are. So then, whenever the Russians came into a town, they used to bring their propaganda. One of the things they used to bring is a bust or a statue of Stalin, a huge statue of Stalin made of concrete or whatever it is. It was very heavy. And it was put up in the center of the town, you know, like God Almighty is there, you know, standing like this and all this jazz. So when we were occupied by the Germans, this Polish police gathered up a number of Jewish men. They made them pull down the statue of Stalin. They made them put the statue of Stalin in a huge wagon driven by several horses. They took the whole Jewish population. No, pardon me. They were not driven by horses. The statue that was on the wagon was driven and pushed by the Jewish men over to the streets of the town. And the Jewish women were forced to follow that wagon and cry and express remorse and, you know, and sorrow and beat their breasts, you know, like, you know, humiliated. We were just right away humiliated. It was bad before the war, the anti-Semitism was so bad. But this was a blanche. It was given to them the power to do with us whatever they felt like. And they right away humiliated us, you know. And the rest of the people, the Gentiles, were standing on both sides of the street and laughing and making fun. You know, it's like the big circus came to town, you know, and they were just laughing and making fun. Look at this and look at that. Look at how they're carrying gun. They're pushing the statue.
Push the statue?
No, too? I did not push the statue, no. But I was the one standing on the side and watching it.
Okay. Was there a German garrison in the town?
There was. There was a small German garrison in the town, yes. They were a substitute, older Germans that would do the work, you know, the logistics, you know. They would run the trains, they would fix the railroad, they would do work, but they were not the fight. They were not the Wehrmacht itself that would go and fight the Russians in the front. They were like, the older sort of, not the prime soldiers. They were just the logistics, you know, supplies and so forth. There was also a unit that was brought in from Lithuania. There was I don't remember how many there were. And there was a captain, he was called the commandant, and my mother worked for him, for this Lithuanian captain that was in charge of this Lithuanian unit that was brought into Austerlitz. And they were also police that were volunteers that worked for the Germans. Okay, volunteers. My mother worked for this captain. I don't remember his name. He was very nice to her. She just did all this housework. She did his washing and the cleaning and the cooking and everything, okay? And for that, she didn't receive any salary or nothing. She just went home, and she was lucky that she didn't get beat up or kicked in or whatever, you know. But he was not abusive to her, okay? Now, the rest of the men would work wherever they were needed, wherever they decided they wanted to do, you know, whether to cut lumber or to fix the railroad that was going through there or to dig ditches or whatever they wanted. They told them to do, and that's what they had to do. That was before the ghetto happened. Then shortly after that, they decided they were going to have a ghetto. So they have taken a certain part of the town, and my father's house happened to be in that section. And they told the rest of the Jews to move into that section. And there was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 5 or 6 homes, buildings, small log buildings, maybe seven. And they had to move in, take whatever little belongings they could, move in. They walled us in. They put a wall around it out of lumber, you know, boards, probably about seven feet tall, 8 feet tall, something like this. And they put a gate around it. And we were kept in a ghetto.
Did you have any personal confrontation either with the Lithuanians or with the German garrison?
I myself?
Personal.
No. I did not know. The only time that... very early is when the German Wehrmacht was going through our town. You know, they stopped there for a short time for rest, maybe a day, day and a half, something like this. And I happened to go through them. And apparently they must have known that I was Jewish because maybe I look Jewish, whatever it is. And one German took his rifle and pointed at me and clicked the clicker. No, I was so scared. But he was just playing with me. There was no round in it. He didn't intend to kill me. He just intended to scare the hell out of me, you know. And I remember that because I was so scared. I think I peed in my pants, you know. I was so scared.
And we will stop now and go to the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape number three. I'm interviewing Mr. Maurice Gordon. How long have you been inside this ghetto in Ostrowiec?
To the best of my memory, I was there till 1943. Early part of 1943. Maybe the end of 1942 or early part of 1943.
Was there any education while you were in the ghetto?
There was no education whatsoever. It was just a waste of time. I mean, we had no education whatsoever. We just wasted time.
Who supplied food for the ghetto?
The food was really not supplied. The food was brought in by the man and the woman that went out of the ghetto every morning to do whatever they were asked to do. And while they were outside, you see, all the Jews knew somebody that were neighbors, Christians, and some of them had good relations, and when they had good relations, they could find out what it is that the Christians would be interested. For example, if the Jews had a pair of shoes, that they could spare it, okay? Because food was very important. If you don't have food, you starve. So they would take whatever they could, whether it was a coat or a jacket or a pair of shoes or a pair of pants or socks or whatever, material things. And they would trade with the Christians for bread, for potatoes. We're talking basic things. Mostly it was bread and potatoes. We're not talking about meat. Meat was not heard of. It was very, very hard. That is the way they would obtain food. And sometimes they would go out in the evening or during the night, just go out and take chances. If they were caught, they would be arrested and maybe shot. And they would go into the smaller villages and trade with the peasants. Okay, and that is how they would obtain food. Now, in our case, and that is my family's case, my grandmother's family, we had very, very, very fine Christian friends, and they would help us. They would give us food without any trading. They just give it to us because they just wanted to do it, and there was no need for anything, and they gave it whatever they could spare. I mean, they weren't exactly well off themselves, but they did it. So we were lucky in that sense that we had those very good Christian friends.
And how did the food from the Christian friends get to you?
Oh, just by bringing it on your person. You go there, you take it in a bag or in a sack or in a pocket or around your body, and you just sneak back into the ghetto. That's about it. You improvise. It wasn't brought with a wagon. It was just little bits and little pieces of food that was being traded and brought in.
Did you yourself go out of the ghetto during that period of time?
No. Only on one occasion did I go out, but I'll go into it later on. But this is the way how food was obtained.
Yeah. Would you explain maybe now
what
was the occasion?
What happened is, shortly after when we were put into the ghetto, there all of a sudden, one morning, the Polish volunteer police came into the ghetto. That was very unusual. My father's older sister that lived in the same house. In my father's house, there were five families. Very small house, families was very crowded. Her name was Sosel. She says, I have this awful feeling something terrible is going to happen. She says, you better go and run away or hide or something because something terrible is going to happen. And so my father and my uncle and all the other men, my father's house was part of the ghetto, but it was like, here's the house and here's the street. So if you open up the door, then you're out in the street. There was a door to the street, but it was supposed to be nailed down so you couldn't open it up. Well, they had it nailed down, but it was nailed down in a way that you could open it up. So they decided right away that they just opened up the door and ran away. And they ran into the forest, okay? The forest was not very far, and some of them ran to friends that they knew. So the upshot of it was, the end of it was that they rounded up, the Polish police rounded up, 10 men. They picked them at random. And also the rabbi was one of the 10 men. And they took him out. Excuse me. They took him out little way beyond the town, maybe a kilometer, maybe less, maybe more. And they shot him. Executed. Just shot him. That's it. Now, at that time, I and my grandmother sneaked out of the ghetto, and we ran towards our friends, Tubis, T-U-B-I-S. Those are the people that helped us, that brought us food, which was maybe about 1.5 kilometers from the ghetto.
It's a small. Was that at night?
No, that was in the morning. That was maybe like 10 o'clock in the morning or so. Maybe. It was in the morning. I remember it was a very gray day, and it was like starting to rain, drizzle. Well, anyway, my grandmother and I, we were running, and as we were running, we were walking, okay, towards the Tubises, because they were going to hide us. This was prearranged. If something bad happens, you and your grandmother go to Tubises, to the Tubis people. So we were on our way there, and as I was walking with my grandmother, I would hear like pow, pow, you know, like hitting on a tin, with something, or bang, bang, pow, pow, you know, like muted noises. Now, I didn't know that they were shooting them. I just heard noise. Later on, the next day, when it quieted down and I came back, I found out that those people were killed. Because later on, the next day, they also made, when the man came back from hiding the other man that survived, they made him go and take the corpses and bury them. Okay, so this is what happened shortly after the Germans came. But the shooting and the rounding up was done by the Polish police, by the volunteers. You see, they couldn't wait for it. They just loved to do it.
Now, you went with your grandmother to Tubis.
Right.
And you mentioned you came back to
Ostrovia. Yes, because once they did their shooting, then it quieted down. Then life went back to the way it was. Now, when we were in the ghetto, it wasn't hunky-dory, you know. Every day there was always being scared. There was always, you didn't know whether today they're going to kill you, or tomorrow they're going to kill you, or in a week they're going to kill you. Every time there was something going on, everybody was scattering around like a bunch of rats, you know, trying to decide where to go, where to hide, what to do, you know. And the house was small, and there was straw on the floor, because that's where people slept upon, you know, with a blanket over it, and it was a mess, you know. And it was very unpleasant, very disorganized, chaotic. So there were the problems also from time to time. The commandant or the officer the in charge of the Polish police would decide that that he wants something, okay, whatever it was. In one instance, a German said that he wants to have a suit made for him. It is in a certain material with a stripe. You know, where in God's are you going to get this material in a stripe to make him a suit? You know, it's not like you walk into a store and you buy material of such and such a stripe and so forth, and you give it to him, okay? So there was a problem. Where are we going to get it? So the elders of the ghetto got together, and they after looking around, searching around, they did find somebody someplace, I don't remember where, that had material with a stripe in it, and they gave it to him, and he was satisfied. Otherwise, he would probably come and shoot a few of us, okay? And another instance, I remember, they said they needed a certain amount, so many grams of gold. Good Lord, the only gold the Jews had in this community, if they're lucky enough, is their wedding band, okay? Or maybe a tooth, okay? Because that is how it was done. If you had teeth, fine. Or if you could afford, fine. Otherwise, it was yanked out. But at any rate, there wasn't many teeth of the gold in there, I can tell you that. But at any rate, I remember my mother. She took off a long time ago when the Germans occupied us, her wedding ring, and she put it in a ball of yarn, you know, you put it, and then you start spinning around it to make a little ball of yarn, and you just threw it in the corner someplace, and that's where it was, you know, like nothing there. So I remember her unwinding the ball of yarn. I watched her do it, and she took out the wedding ring, and she gave it to the elders, because you had to do it, you know, otherwise they would come in and kill you. Whatever they decided they wanted to do, they did it. So that was the big deal about the gold. But this is things like that. There were always demand made upon the community. I remember one time a Polish volunteer policeman came into the ghetto. He wanted a pocket watch. Now, a pocket watch, a watch in that community, in that town, was a great luxury. He wanted a pocket watch. So he was talking to my Uncle Ben, and he was friendly with my Uncle Ben. You know, you could say that maybe he was a friend of my Uncle Ben's, okay? Through knowing him, okay, through dealing with him before the war. So he told him that he's looking for a watch. And he, I'll never forget it. And then he says to my Uncle Ben, says, I don't know anybody that has a watch. He says, by the way, Ben, what time is it? My Uncle Ben had his watch right here, you see. And my Uncle Ben thought very fast. He didn't grab like this here, because if he'd worn like this here, he'd say, oh, give me a watch. So you see, this is that type of mentality that was going on right there. This is how so-called friends or assumed friends treated you when they had the power. It was, friendship was nothing, even though if they were so-called friends, because we were killed by so-called neighbors, by so-called friends. So what does it all mean, you see? And that was about the daily life. Now, I remember an instance when those 10 men were shot. There was one young man, he was a distant relative to me. His name was Abraham Wittenberg. That was my mother's maiden name. So he was related like a second cousin and so forth to my mother. So, and this young man, he was a powerful man. I mean, he was so powerful. It is just, he was one of them. And when he realized they were going to shoot him, you know, they just put him up and then they started to shoot. He started to run towards the police. The Polish police was shooting him because he wanted to get a hold of one. And that particular person that was telling the story, he was bragging. He said, I keep shooting him and shooting him, and he kept running towards me. You know, that if he could only lay his hands on him, he would tear him apart. You see, and he was bragging about it, how, you know, what a marksman he was, how he was shooting him. And as a matter of fact, a cousin of his is still alive. He survived. He lives in Connecticut. His name is Chaim Eli. And he's also a powerful man. God, he's powerful. When he was younger, he could lift a house. I mean, he was so powerful. So it runs in their bloodline, you know. But his family got all killed. I mean, his mother and father and sister and he, they got all killed in that little town. So this was basically the life that was going on. It was bad before the war, during the Polish, while we lived under the Polish rule. It was a million times worse because they couldn't wait, you know, to do whatever they hoped in their heart they could do, you know, a long time ago, and they got the chance to do it.
Who was the head of the Jewish community?
Okay. The head of the Jewish community, there were certain elders, a number of people, maybe three or four, and they were elected by the community. They were sort of people that were respected by the rest of the Jews, okay? But the head of that particular number of people was a man called Romorovsky, Abraham Romorovsky, he and his wife. He, whenever the Germans demanded certain things from the Jewish community, he had to face them. He came out and said, okay, I represent, you know, somebody had to talk to them because just didn't talk to anybody. So he would be the one that would have to go and talk to them, and they would say, now we want this and this and this and so on. So, okay, so he was the head. He was Romorovsky, yes. He and his wife died. They never survived.
Did your father do in the ghetto, within the ghetto period?
Okay, that's interesting because my father's work was, everybody had to do work, but my father's work was, there was about a kilometer from Ostrowice, there was a refinery that they used to refine, make turpentine. Now, turpentine in our community, in our part of Poland, that town, in that refinery, was made out of, when trees were cut down, the roots were left in the ground. And a lot of those roots were from pine trees. And he and other Jewish men would go, and physically, with a shovel and an axe, they would dig out those huge, huge roots. They would pull them out by pulleys, put them on a wagon that was horse-driven, take them to this refinery, which was not far away, and they would place those roots into an oven. It's like it looked like a huge teepee, okay, that was built out of stone, out of bricks, and they would fill that cavity with those roots, and then they would close the entrance, and underneath it they would fire. There was a fire, so it would create a great deal of heat, and it would make this liquid that would pitch. I think it's called pitch, right? Drain it off, and then once that drained off into a channel, into a trough, into a reservoir, it was then processed to different liquids and so forth. So that was one of his jobs. That was every day is to go and do that. For that, he didn't get paid. It was like he didn't get his ass kicked in. Okay, and then after that, he worked in a place where they used to make bricks. And it's funny, you know, when I thought of it, I said, oh, my God, history is repeating itself. There it was in Egypt during the times of the pharaohs, when the Jews were forced to stand in this mud with straw and knit this mud or clay and straw to create bricks for the building of the palace or the pharaohs and the pyramids and so forth, whatever they were doing. Here is my father, after so many thousands of years, doing the exact same thing, you know? What an irony that nothing is new and nothing is learned. And he would do that. They would go, a bunch of Jewish men, they would excavate the clay from a huge excavation place, okay? They put it in carts. They would bring it to a place where there was, in the ground, it was a circular trough with an anchored stake, huge wooden log. This was anchored. And to that, around that thing, there was like pedals that were going out. So it's like a fan, you know? And there was a huge wooden, heavy log that was connected to that, that was extending to the end of the trough. And to that, they would hitch on a horse. And the horse would keep going around in a circle. And as he was going around a circle, those pedals would mix the water and the sand proportions and the clay, knit it into a product that then when it was mixed properly, my father would go in barefoot into that trough, and he would, with a shovel, put it on a wheelbarrow, shovel it into a wheelbarrow, and then bring it over to a building that they had little forms, okay? And they would take that clay, put it in the form, and run it a level wooden board over it to level it off. And there were two bricks in each side. And then they would take the bricks, and they would put it on a platform for drying. You had to dry that. And there was thousands of bricks made over a period of time. And then when there was sufficient drying done and the sufficient amount of bricks accumulated, they would take those bricks. And there was a huge, huge building that was an oven that underneath it, they would store the bricks and store them like this in such a way where fire could go between them, you know, arrange them in such a way. And then they would close the entrances. And on the second level above it, there were openings that they would fire it. They would throw in logs with fire, and it would create a tremendous amount of heat. And the process, it took I don't remember how many days of certain temperatures of heat to fire it, to make it strong, okay? Like making, bricks are being made under fire, so it would become hard and strong. It's a certain process. And then they would give it a period of time to cool it off. While it was cooling off, the same process was going on, mixing of the clay, making the bricks and drying them again, and the process went on and on like this here. And that was his job, okay? And that was very hard work. And for that, he didn't get any bread or any water or nothing. He had supply, everything, meager exist, whatever he could get from trading with the Christians. And so, as I said, history repeated itself after so many thousands of years. My father was making bricks for the Germans.
How long did you stay in the Ostrowiec ghetto?
I stayed in Ostrowiec ghetto to the end of 42 or beginning of 43.
And what happened then?
Well, there was, well, I didn't know it then, but I know it now, that there was this Wannsee conference in January 20, 1942, where the Germans, well, one of the guys there that I know was Eichmann, okay, and there were the rest of the gang over there, Himmler and Heinrich, whatever the guy was that they killed in Czechoslovakia, whatever it is. But they, all these big makimakis, they decided they're going to have the final solution. They're going to get rid of the Jews, of all the little towns and all the little ghettos, you know. They're going to round them up, and they're going to get rid of them. Now, there was some talk going on, and my parents asked me if would I mind to go with my grandmother, because my grandmother was elderly now. My grandmother, that was my mother's mother. If we wouldn't mind to go to Vilno Ghetto, because Vilno Ghetto at that time was huge. I think there was maybe like 20,000 Jews in there. I mean, it was huge. It was a monster. Okay, and to me, it was absolutely it was huge compared to Auschwitz. Auschwitz was like a speck, you know. And they didn't exactly tell me why, but I had an idea that they. It would be easier for them to escape and to our Christian friends in case there was danger. And so I agreed. And at that time, when they were asking me, they knew somehow that my mother's brother that lived with his family, with his wife and his son, and my mother's sister, Lisa, in Vilna Ghetto. And they said that you will go there and be with them and you'll be safe. But they also knew that there was my mother's brother, his name is Elia Wittenberg, were coming to a station called Gudogai, a railway station, approximately maybe 5 kilometers, 3.5 miles, something like this, from Ostrovets, to load lumber, lugs, on railroad tracks, on railroad cars, you know, flat cars, to take it to Vilnius. He was part of the group of the Jews that were sent from Vilnius to do that labor. So my other uncle Ben that lived in Ostrovets said that I will take you there. And in the evening, my grandmother and I and my uncle Ben took us over there. And I can remember, it is as vivid to me now, I can remember my father standing at the fence of the ghetto, watching me go by and crying. That was the last picture in my mind I have of my father. My mother said goodbye to me at her own time, in her own way. She wasn't there watching me. I don't know what she did.
How did you leave the ghetto physically?
Oh, very simple. There was nothing to it. We just walked out, and there were no guards. You see, the only time that you were in trouble is if you were caught. But if you weren't caught, then there was nothing. You see, but of course there was a danger.
So who was together? You?
So my grandmother and I went to the station, and we got on the train with my uncle, and we went towards Vilnius. And when we came into Vilnius, that was approximately 50 kilometers ride, I think. When we came into Vilnius, a railroad station, my uncle and the other people that were doing the labor did whatever they had to do, and then they were told to go back to the ghetto, and I and my grandmother went with them to the ghetto because they walked as a group, you know. You couldn't walk on the sidewalk. That was against the law. You had to walk next to the sidewalk on the street. Okay, Jews were not supposed to walk on the sidewalk. And I entered the ghetto. And when I entered the ghetto, there was one huge entrance that was, I believe, on Rudnitske Gas. Anyway, and there were Germans that were sort of looking around, and there were Jewish police that was also searching you. You see, the irony of it all is, the Germans were searching you because every time the Jews went out, they used to bring in something, food. They used to put it in their in their clothes, you know, make tunnels in their clothes, you know, push, stuff it in. They used to wear it in their socks. They used to wear it in their pockets. Anything that they could find, that they could procure, they would bring in food in the ghetto. So they were searched constantly. And some Jewish policemen would just not paying attention. They would just let them in. Now, some other ones would confiscate it from them. That is, and I got in the ghetto just by the virtue of going through it, and I was being noticed, my grandmother also, and I was supposed to appear before a Jewish magistrate, and he asked me questions, how did I get in here, and so forth and so on. I told him that I came with my uncle, and he asked me whether we paid anybody any money for the transportation. How did we get in the train? I said, no, we didn't pay anybody nothing. I got in the train with my uncle, and I came. And that was dropped. And that is how I wound up in the Vilna ghetto. Okay. So that is, and now, later on, back to Austerlitz. In 1943, they started to round up the ghettos. There was Austerlitz, there was Oshmenya, there was Smorgon, there was Shumsk, there was Sol. There were lots of little ghettos scattered all the way around, you know, maybe 50 Jews here, 100 here, and so forth. And they get Bistrovitz, there was also another one. In Bistrovitz, there was my mother's oldest sister with her family, which was about a day's ride by horse and wagon from Austerlitz. So they rounded them all up. And the whole idea of me and my grandmother going to Vilna ghetto is to give my parents a free hand to escape. And so when they started to round up the small ghettos, my mother went out from the ghetto, and this Mr. Tubis was waiting for her. And he said to her, go and get your husband, and I will hide you. So she went into the ghetto, and she asked her husband, please come with me. The Tubises are waiting to hide you. Now, my father didn't go. My father says, no, I cannot go. My father, maybe he felt responsible. There were two sisters that he had in the ghetto. And maybe he had hopes that he would go to Vilna, you know, because they told him they were going to send him towards Vilna, and he would exit quietly with my mother and join me. Now, I don't know what my father thought. I'm just speculating. But the fact is that my father did not go with my mother, and my mother came back into the ghetto, and she went with him.
We will stop now and go to the next tape. This is tape number 4. I am interviewing Mr. Maurice Gordon. You were talking about your parents, your mother going back into the ghetto. What happened next?
Okay. My father would not go. He just didn't go. He wanted to stay with his sisters. And like I said, he thought maybe when they get to Vilna, they gathered up all these Jews, and it was like very friendly. They said that they were going to send them to work in a different part of the country where they were needed for work. So There wasn't much of brutality or anything. They just said, take as many belongings as you could possibly carry, and we will. They took him to Gudogai, which was the station, and they put him on the train, and there were hardly any guards. You know, it was like very sort of nothing extraordinary for that, for that time, for that life, you know. And then, of course, the cars were like cattle cars, you know. So they gathered up many thousands of Jews from the small villages and so forth. And they put them in those trains, and the train started to move towards Vilnius, and then they stopped at certain locations to gather more Jews, and as they stopped, they put on more guards, many more guards, and then they made it very difficult if somebody wanted to escape, very difficult because they would shoot you. So now my thinking was that the reason my father decided to go with that transport is that he was hoping to get to Vilnius and then exit and then join me. But I may be wrong. I'm just speculating, like I said before. The end result of it was that they took all this transport of Jews and they took him to a place called Ponar, which is outside of Vilnius in a forest. This location was built by the Russians in the period of 39 to 41. It was a place where they were going to store petrol products, gasoline, oil, whatever it is, for their war machine. Okay. It was in a forest. It would be easy to camouflage. So they dug out huge, huge round holes to store the product and then cover it up. Excuse me. And the Germans used that place. There was a railroad track right to it. The Russians built a railroad track right to it so they could bring the products. So it was very convenient. They just shifted and they went on this railroad track and they took the Jews to that place. By the time that happened, there were lots of guards. And the guards that were then employed at that period of the transport were Lithuanians, there were Latvians, there were Ukrainians, and there were Polish volunteers, killers. They enjoyed doing that. They waited for it probably their lifetime to fulfill their dream. The Germans were there just to supervise, you know, that the job was done. So when they came close to that area, there was a staging place. They made the people, they took them out in groups. They told them to undress. They took him out to those graves, those holes, and they shot him. Now, I have problems with that because I visualize, you know, many times I visualize my mother, you know, being undressed, being humiliated, being so forlorn, you know, without any hope. What was she thinking about then? I'm sure my mother was a religious person. I wonder what kind of questions she was asking God, you know. I wonder what was going on through her mind. What horror she must have faced, you know, to be treated in such an awful way and to be killed in such a horrible way. I couldn't describe the words that would be just in if I could only know how she felt, if I could only understand it, if I am trying to put myself in her place and I cannot put myself in her place because I wasn't there, because I wasn't faced with it. And I'll never know what she thought, how she felt. Now, that goes for all that. When I speak about my mother, I speak about everybody, you know. I mean, it's relative, all those people. All those children, all those mothers that carry their children, you know, next to their body, and how awful they felt, how they tried to protect them. I'm sure that at the last moment, they still must have had some hope, because how could humanity be so darn rotten to do such a thing to another human being?
When did you find out that that's what happened to your parents and the relatives?
Okay. My father, when they were doing all the shooting. Okay, they selected certain men to take the belongings and put it back in the trains. So they would take it back into Vilnius, okay? So he was selected as one of them. And I know a person by the name of Aaron Weiner, with a W, W-E-I-N-E-R, that came from the same town, Ostrovets, that was on the same transport to be killed. He saw my father being shot. My father was trying to hide among those belongings, you know, make a little hiding place, and he was kind of discovered, you know. And so he was, when he was discovered, my father started to run away, and he was being shot and then dragged and dumped in the hole. Now, this Mr. Weiner, he was also being shot, but it so happened that he fell into the grave alive. And by some miracle, he survived, okay, after the corpses, other people that fell on top of him, covered him up, and so forth. And he crawled out. I don't know the details because it wasn't told to me. I saw him, okay? I was a little boy. Things were not. I'm going to explain it to you later on. You see, when he survived and he came to Vilna Ghetto, he got into Vilna Ghetto, and he knew that my mother's brother, older brother, and sister are there. And he found us. And he he knew my grandmother was there. Okay, and he knew that I was there. So when he found us, he walked into our place where we were living there in the little room, okay, in the Vilna Ghetto. And I remember my grandmother was howling. She was crying, you know. So I knew something terrible happened, okay. And they didn't tell me that my parents were killed. They told me that my parents went to the tubuses because the whole idea of it was for me and my grandmother to go to Vilna Ghetto so my mother and father could go and escape and go to tubuses, you see. So I didn't suspect. I believed them. I said, well, you know, they're telling me that my parents survived, and I believed them. And also they would write letters, you know, my relatives in the Vilna Ghetto, write letters and tell and read it to me and say that it came from my mother and father, which, you know, I believed them, okay. But they tried to hide it from me. But I know my grandmother and everybody was crying. It was terrible when they found out. It, on top of all the horror, you know, there was all of this here. Okay, it's not that it was unusual. People were dying every day by the thousands or by the hundreds, you know, or by the tens. And so I thought for a long, long time that my parents were alive. Now, in a sense, you know, I want to say something. It is not as much my parents, because my parents, if there's a measure of longevity, you know, of how long a person lives, well, maybe I don't even know their age. Maybe they were 45, because they married old, and I was 10 years old at that time. So they were probably in their late 40s. But I had shucks, I've got to control myself. I had my mother's oldest sister. She was the oldest one. She lived in a village about a day's ride by horse and buggy. It was called Bystrovets. Her husband died. She had three boys and two girls. And they were so poor, you know. We helped them, the family, you know, helped them with whatever we could. And she was such a proud lady. And she brought up her children. But it was such nice people. At one time, my mother took me over there for a visit. And I met them all, and I remember them. And then, at another time, when we were occupied by the Germans, two little girls, my cousin, came to my grandmother for a short stay. Now, one little girl's name, the older one, was called Fegele, which means really bird in Jewish. Okay. And the younger one was called Dora, Tverale. And the older girl, there was some shooting going on in the village in Bystrovitz, okay? And she happened to walk into the crossfire, and a bullet hit her arm. So she had a crippled arm, you know, injured, crippled arm. And I never heard her complain, you know, her useless arm. I never heard her complain. And her younger sister, Dverle, you know, whenever I think of her, I always see her. She had such a small little face, you know. And it was pure like milk. She looked like a little, well, an angel, okay? She was such a nice little thing. She was so pleasant to be around with. You know, she would move around like she wasn't even there. She was so quiet, like a little bird. And when I think of her, you know, I visualize the Pietà, where Mary is holding the body, the dead body of Christ, and she's mourning over him and for him. Well, I see my little cousin holding all those 6 million people, all those little boys and little girls. And mourning for them and over them. And that is something that is, shucks. That is something that's very hard for me to understand, you know. And no matter how many questions I ask, why? Why her? Why all those little children? They haven't done anything to anybody. They didn't know what life is all about. She, my little cousin that I'm speaking about, she would have made a wonderful, beautiful mother. And she would have brought into this world a life that would have been so nice. Always have trouble with that. And she never had a chance, you know. She died such an awful way, horrible way to die. And her whole family, they all died. You know, when you think about it. What is it all about? I mean, how could people be like this? I mean, I've been searching for answers all my adult life, since the time that I could start to reason. Because all those facts that I'm talking about were registered right in here, and they just wandered around in my conscious and subconscious, and they would come and go. And I wasn't able to talk about it because I was so angry, and because it was too close for a long time. Short, you know, after the war, it was too close. I couldn't touch it. I could distance myself now a little bit, you know, and try to look at it and try to rationalize, if there's such a thing that you could wrestle about it, but at least try to ask the questions and try to find maybe there's some kind of an answer. So far, I haven't found any answers for what was done. I don't think there's ever going to be an answer for what was done. I don't know how to finish that. I don't know, because the only time that this is going to finish with me is when I die. So it is very important for me to have this document made. But anyway, so this is something that was done to those people, and this horrible thing. Then later on, as the Germans were starting to lose, you know, their battles, the Russians were starting to beat them. They took some Jews from Vilna Ghetto. They made them dig up those graves. They took out the corpses. They put them in, they spread them among logs, you know, and they set them on fire and they burned them. So I don't know where my parents are really buried, because I couldn't go to their grave and mourn them or to comfort myself or anything. There's just thousands upon thousands of people buried there that are all burned. I was there after the war. It was just yellow sand, and I could find pieces of bones and hair and so forth that was scattered around, you know, in that vicinity where they did the burning.
How long did you yourself stay in the Vilna Ghetto?
I was in the Vilna Ghetto from probably beginning of 43 till the very end, which was, I believe, September 2, 1943, when they liquidated the ghetto.
Were you with your grandmother?
Yes, I was always with my grandmother, yes, yeah. And with my Uncle El and my Aunt Lisa. Now, excuse me. When my mother and father and all these other people and all my relatives and all the Jews were killed in Ponar, the clothes that my father was helping to put back into the trains were being shipped back to Vilna. And my Aunt Lisa, my mother's younger sister, worked in a place where they would gather all the clothes that came back from all the shootings. They would separate in different categories, whatever the Germans could use for the front, like something warm, whatever it is, you know, that they needed, they would send it there. The rest they would send wherever they were sending. My aunt told, she didn't tell me that for a very long time, that she recognized my mother's clothes. Because we didn't have many clothes, there's certain items that she would recognize. And she said, my Aunt Lisa, that's still alive, she's 81. She said that she wanted to commit suicide. That's how terrible she felt. She didn't tell me about it for a very, very, very long time. She tried to protect my feelings, you know. So, anyway, then I was in ghetto. And the ghetto life in Vilna ghetto, it was a huge ghetto, like I said. And there was a Judenrat. A Judenrat means a Jewish government, okay. And the head of the government, I remember, was Gens. He was a Lithuanian Jew. He was an officer in the Lithuanian army before the war. He was an educated person, and he was the head of the ghetto. Under him, there was Dessler. I know nothing about him. I just remember the name. And then there was another guy called Levas, and Levas is another Lithuanian Jew. And then there were other officers, and there was police and so forth. But it was a Jewish government. Excuse me. So when the Germans made demands that they needed 200 people, 1,000 people, 3,000 people, whatever, okay, they put the demands to the Jewish government in the ghetto. And they said, you have to supply me so many people. And so there were white passes and there were yellow passes. I think if you had a yellow pass, you were in demand. You had an occupation that was dear to the Germans, so therefore you were safer. So they started looking around, show me your pass, your white pass, come with us. And you were taken away. Yellow pass, you were saved. Until they used up all the white pass and then went to the yellow passes. But when they would take them away, In some instances, they would just kill them. In other instances, now, I didn't see them kill him, okay? But they never returned and never survived. So whether they took him to Penari or they took him to some concentration camp or they took him to a labor camp, the fact is that they didn't come back and they're dead. Now, Vilno had a huge Jewish population. So there were things like that. But otherwise, the Jews went out of the ghetto every day. Men and women, the children were left behind and old people were behind. And they worked for the Germans or they worked for the Polish, whoever they were told, whatever to do and whoever to work for, they did it. And then they would come back and they would try to bring in a little food. They would also smuggle in food. There were some people that took awful risks. They would come in through the sewers. In Vilno had huge sewers. You could walk through some of them. And then they had branches that were smaller. You had to crawl through them. Can you imagine crawling in that filth, you know, just to bring in something? So they took great risks to bring it in, but you had to have food. You know, cold is one thing. I mean, you could somehow stand cold, but without food you die. So it was very important. And the constant roundups, constant hiding, constantly being in fear. In Ostrovets ghetto, what, on a small scale, but fear is fear no matter where you are, okay? That was on a big scale. And every time there was a roundup, we would hide. Everybody had a hiding place that they prepared long ago. It was usually either a partition the room where a false wall was made, you know, with an entrance that was concealed, or in a basement, in the foundation of the house, in a basement that was, because the entrance was concealed, you know. And when there was a roundup, people would go and hide. And of course, when they came to select people and they weren't there, they knew they were hiding, so start to look for them. And they would find them, and they would satisfy 1,000 or 2,000 people, and then it would stop, and then the rats would crawl out again from the hiding places. I call myself the rats because that's what we were like. And we would survive till the next roundup, and so on and so forth, you know, and that's the way it was going on. We had three hideout places. One was immediately in that area of the building that we lived. There were two of them, and one was several blocks away, maybe 10 minutes walking time. And that was our last hideout, and this hideout, this building was located. The wall that faced the outside wall that faced toward the street was the boundary of the walled-in ghetto. So if you go through the wall of that building, you're on the outside of the street, on the outside of the ghetto. There was a street, okay? So they went into the basement and they dug, first they dug in like a manhole, okay, maybe 4 or 5 feet deep. And they reinforced it with little boards so it wouldn't collapse. And because Vilnius had such huge sewers, they dug deep into, underneath the sewers, and came out on the other side of the street into another building, into a basement. Now, the engineering was done by, it was a very narrow place, tunnel. The tunnel was very narrow. It was just enough to squeeze yourself through, so they dug it. And they put it. They put the sand or the earth in a little box that was attached to the rope from both sides. And people would pull it out. They would dump it, and then the other people would pull it back in and fill it up, and so forth. And every time they would dig a certain distance, they would reinforce it with like a T, you know, one board support on each side, and let's continue like this here. They also had to see where they were going, so they strung electric lights on it. Now, the lights in the city were direct current. There wasn't alternative current, just direct current. And the reason I'm saying that is I'll come to it later on. So this is how they prepared this hideout place. So that when the time was to really hide, when they were going to liquidate the ghetto, that we would go in through this tunnel, come out on the outside of the ghetto into the building, into the basement of the outside building, and then the entrance from the ghetto in the basement would be covered up with earth, A lot of things would be thrown on it. So when the so-called the Lithuanians and the Latvians and the Estonians and the Ukrainians that were in the polls that were looking for us and for the Jews to liquidate them would get into that basement, they would say, if they were found out, they were already taken out, there's nothing but a mess, there's nobody there, and they wouldn't be suspicious of anything else. Okay, and that's what happened. Because there were some young people, there were a number of young people that sort of had an organization that were going to run away to the Jewish partisans into the forest. And they were the ones that threw all that earth on it and all that junk on it, okay? And then they disappeared. So now, when the time came to have the ghetto liquidated, this was in September 1943.
How did you know that the liquidation is coming up?
Well, they announced. They're liquidating the ghetto. In other words, they're taking everybody out, and they told you they were going to send you some other place, send you, kill you, that's about it, or whatever. They liquidated the ghetto. So there were about 65 people, give or take a few, that got into that hiding place.
Your grandmother and yourself?
My grandmother was, and I were one of us, and my relatives, that is my Uncle Al and his wife and his son, and Mr. Levine, that was friendly to help me, and my Aunt Lisa and her husband, those were my immediate, and Mr. Levine's brother and his wife and his daughter. Those were my immediate relatives, okay, and relatives by marriage. So we were part of it. And as I was, the time was to go into the tunnel, go out into the hiding place outside the ghetto, and I was crawling through the tunnel. For some reason, I touched the wire. The wire was just strung along, you know, the electric wire, and apparently one part that I touched by accident was bare, and it caught me right here. And being the current was not alternative current, I couldn't rip myself away from it. And I was so grounded, you know, in the earth. And I couldn't do anything. I became paralyzed. I just went, oh, you know. And Mr. Levine was ahead of me. And he heard me, you know, suffocate, you know, being paralyzed. And he realized that that the wire caught me. And what he did, he jerked on that wire. You know, he just grabbed the wire and jerked, and that disconnected me. And so I survived. Otherwise, I would have been electrocuted. My heart would have stopped, you know, by being paralyzed and so forth. So I had a hell of a burn right here. But the burn is nothing. The idea is that there must be a reason why I survived, because I could have been electrocuted right there. Anyway, we were in that hiding place, and it took him 3 days to liquidate the ghetto. And we used to see, because that hiding place, that street, was right not far from the main gate, from the ghetto gate. So when they used to bring out the Jews, you know, in sort of, you know, like a whole bunch of Jews, just bring them out under guard, we could see them, you know, being brought out, just brought out in bunches, brought out till there was nothing else to bring out. And we stayed there because the guards, there were an awful lot of guards. At one point in time, during the time when they were bringing out the Jews, there was rain. And from that basement, there were steps and a door that you could go out into the street to be free, okay, into the outside of the ghetto. So when it was raining, the guards wanted to get some shelter. So they started to push on the door to enter the basement from the outside, okay? And some of the men in that hiding place ran up to the door and they put their shoulders to it, you know, prevent from opening up. And the luck, as luck would have it, some of their friends, the comrades, you know, those guards, shouted, "Hey, you guys come here, we broke open another door."
We will stop now and go to the next step. This is tape number 5. I'm interviewing Mr. Maurice Gordon. You were talking about the entrance that the guards tried to get in.
Right. Okay. So their bodies broke open the next entrance to the next basement. And it was just so relative, it was really the next basement, because the only thing that divided was a heavy brick wall. Okay. And there was also a pipe, a water pipe that was cut off at both ends, so at an angle, so you couldn't really see because it was an angle, but you could hear them, okay? So we plugged up the pipe, so it would be, because we had to be so quiet, because if they heard anybody sneeze, you know, they would be suspicious, and they would break, and we would be discovered. That would be the end of us, okay? So mostly, I can tell you, we were just lucky. So we stay there. Mr. Levine, that took sort of responsibility for me, and Mr. Levine knew Vilnius very, very well. He lived there a long time. He knew a lot of Christian people. He had a lot of Christian friends that he got along very well with them. He used to deal with them, you know, in business, and they were very nice and cordial to each other, and they developed a great friendship, and they had a lot of respect. So Mr. Levine had people that he could depend upon, Christians, for help. So Mr. Levine, on the 10th day, said to me, "You will go with me." And as the evening came, we just opened up the door and looked around if there's any guard. Because there were guards walking around from time to time, not very few in between, because the whole thing was over, you know. And we got out, and we closed the door behind us, and I followed him. And I remember, you know, I was sitting. It was so cramped in that place that you had to sit so close, you know. You could not extend your arms. You couldn't. All we had was dried bread and water, okay? We prepared dried bread and water, okay? And when we had to go and do our sanitary things, you know, it was in a bucket that we used to put it in the channel that we dug, okay, just put it there. And so it was very stuffy, it was very stinky, it was very terrible, it was crampy. And when I walked out and I started to walk, my legs just buckled, you know. And so it took me a little while sort of to get up to speed. Excuse me. And I was wearing the only coat that my parents gave me. That was a sheep skin coat that the fleece was inside, and the outside it was just, you know, like a leather, okay, rough leather. And at that time of the year, you know, people didn't wear it, you know. It would be suspicious, you know. Somebody would think you're a lunatic or something. Why are you wearing such a heavy coat when it's not even that cold? But that is all I had, so I wore it. But at that time, I said to myself, "My God, this is terrible. You know, this is not good. They're going to think that you're a Jew." But anyway, it was dark, and Mr. Levine and I, we walked for a certain length of time when we got out on the outskirts of Vilnius, and he went to a person, a friend, a Polish friend, by the name of Vladek Majewski, and he knocked on his door. And of course, Majewski recognized him right away. And, you know, they greeted each other. And he says, "My God," he couldn't believe it, "he's alive, you know." And he says, "My God," you know, and Levine expressed to him what his desire is. He says, "Would you take us in, you know, to hide us for a short time, for as long as you can hide us?" And Mr. Majewski says, "Yes." And Mr. Levine says, "Well, there will be more people coming, because some more of my relatives that are hiding in the ghetto, and they will be coming out, and they will be coming here." He says, "That's fine." And so Mr. Levine, I, my grandmother, and my grandmother's younger daughter, which is Lisa, wound up with Mr. Majewski. But my grandmother and Lisa, they left after us. Soon after, and we said that we will go first, you will go after us, so maybe you'll be like 10 minutes behind us or something like this here. Well, hours went by, said, well, they were caught and they were shot. Well, the upshot of it was that my aunt got disoriented and she got lost. And she didn't know how to get to the place. So she knew the general area of it, how it is called, you know, that area, what it is called. But she didn't know how to get there. So she knocked on a door. She said they were so desperate they were going to commit suicide. I mean, she was so scared that they were going to be caught, so it would better to be commit suicide. And she finally knocked on a door, and she said, could you tell me just a general direction, you know, towards the area, not the street, but the area. And the people told her where she was and where that particular area of the town is. And so she got her bearings again. And once she got her bearings, she came to that particular part of town. She knew where she was, and she knew where Mr. Majewski was, and she came to us. So that was another miracle. So then my mother's brother and his wife and his son went to another Christian person. I don't remember his name. And they hid them there. And so we were in two different places. And there was another family related by marriage to me. There were Levin, there was Cole, there was Mr. and Mrs. Levin, the daughter. They went to another place that was still, the Germans had Jews there working for them. I think it was called Hakape. And they entered that place. So that's how we were scattered. Now, the Germans had an idea, and so did the other, those lackeys of theirs that did all the dirty work for them, that some Jews survived and they ran away and they're scattered about somewhere in the city. So they sent out, you know, snoopers to snoop around. Usually they had an idea that they would be on the outskirts of the city, where it's quiet, you know, little town, little so forth. And my Uncle Al, they came to that person and they started to ask around, do you see any Jews and so forth? And they said, no. And they said, would you mind if we look? And they said, no, go and look. So they went into the barn. My Uncle Al was in the barn. In the attic, there was this partition, and he was behind the partition, like a false partition. He and his wife and his son. And those policemen, those volunteers, they were in the attic looking around. And they were just like so close to the partition. And my Uncle Bell told me the story that he started to say the prayers for the dead, you know. And they were not discovered by some miracle. So they survived. And now, we had another, my mother's brother, that was named Benjamin. He was very instrumental in bringing us, you know, in, he arranged with his Polish friends to help us, to hide us. He had a lot of Polish friends. One of his closest friends was the Tubis family. And he was hiding in the vicinity of the Tubis family, which was about a mile or so, give or take, from Ostrowitz, a little village. And we gave word to Mr. Majewski that we have survived, a number of us have survived, and that we are with him, and that we need somebody to come and take us away from here to another hiding place. So the Tubises arranged all the logistics. They hired a neighbor of theirs that they could depend upon. And he had a horse and a carriage. And he drove to that outskirts of Vilnius. And first he took my grandmother, me, my aunt, and Mr. Levine. He took us back to Ostrowitz, to the Tubises, where my Uncle Ben was waiting for us. And when we came there at night, I remember, we were driving right in front of the Germans, you know. We were going through railroad crossings, and the Germans were there, I mean, in the open daylight. We started at daylight, but it was a whole day's trip by crossing and carriage, and we wound up night, late at night, when we met my Uncle Ben in Ostrowitz at a certain appointed area at a crossing of some place where it was a
where you covered in the horse?
In the open, just in the open. If they stopped us and they wanted to look around, that was the end of us, you know. That's it. It just so happened, you know, things happen. They just happen. You just press your luck and that's it. You have luck and you survive. So Uncle Ben met us and he took us to a person the same night, Karavetsky. Their name was Karavetsky. There was Mr. and Mrs. Karavetsky, then a son and a daughter. And they told my Uncle Ben that we would be allowed to stay with them in their house. It was a small village for 10 days. And my other relatives went to a different place. They were also brought with that same person by the horse and carriage that went back and got them. The upshot was that they rounded up during a period of time 12 people, 12 of my relatives, direct blood relatives, and relatives by marriage. Okay. And we stayed with the Karavetsky, that's myself, my grandmother, my aunt, for 10 days. And then from there we went to Dubok. Dubok is a tiny little village that is somewhere in the woods. It's like far away from civilization. The Germans wouldn't show up there. It just was insignificant. This area was controlled by the Polish and the Russian partisans. So my mother's younger sister, that Dverele she's called, that was a twin sister to my Aunt Lisa, she married during the war, a Mr. Bublewicz. He was a Christian, Polish. Aleksander Bublewicz. Aleksander Bublewicz, we knew all our lives. I mean, he was very friendly. He was a very nice person. He was not an anti-Semite, you know. He was a good person. We always got along with him, always friendly with him. He loved my mother's sister, and she married him. And she lived free in the open because she was blonde, blue-eyed. And they lived in Molodechno. There was a city, Molodechno. He used to work on the railroad. He was a railroad engineer, drive a railroad locomotive, okay. And he had second cousins in Dubok that was called, and a family called Romanovsky. There was a mother. There were four brothers and three sisters. One of the brothers that was married, he had a family, he had a little girl and a boy. He was on his own, and he had a log house that really there was like one part, half of the house was the bedroom, the living room, the kitchen, the dining room, everything, okay? And the other half of the house that divided by logs also with a door into it was not even finished yet. It was just no windows, nothing. And this Mr. Bublewicz that was related to him came over and talked to him. He says, we need a hiding place to hide 12 people, 12 Jews. And we will reward you for it. I don't know what was promised to him. But whatever was promised wasn't worth it. Because if we were discovered, he would be tortured. Us, they would kill right away. But him, in his family and his children, they would just cut him to pieces just to make an example of them. So he agreed to hide us. So his brothers, the Romanovsky brothers, came and they dug a bunker in that undeveloped part of the house. It was approximately like 10 feet wide, maybe like 16 feet long, and about maybe 3.5-4 feet high. And it was all made out of logs, you know, the sides and the roof was logs. And then they put straw on top of the roof. And then they covered it with about 3 or 4 feet of dirt. Now, the dirt that they excavated, they dumped. It was right next to the house, down an incline. There was a river. They dumped it towards the river because they had to hide the dirt. And there was one louver for air was there, like a square louver that was boxed from boards that was just touching the foundation that they threw a lot of logs to camouflage it, because we had to have some kind of air coming in case it would have to be cut, the entrance would have to be covered in case we would have to go in hiding for whatever reason, if the Germans would come there or if the Polish partisans would come there. Because the Polish partisans, they would kill the Jews, the Russian partisans, and the Germans. They did ethnic cleansing. That was their idea of justice. So we were in grave danger from the Polish partisans. The Russian partisans wouldn't do anything to us, but we just didn't want them to know that we were there, because maybe somebody would say something to somebody, and before you know it, somebody in the village would find out that the Jews are there, and we were finished. Because the mouth, you know, would talk. And you have to be very careful, you have to be very secretive. So, but the Polish partisans, they were death. They would kill us just like that. On one occasion, the Polish partisans moved into the village. And we had to go under. We had to go into the bunker. And the entrance was like a half of a wooden barrel that was cut out. And it was put in, you know, and then there was the soil would come up to the top. And it was sort of like pitching like this. So when you put the cover on it and you put a lot of other soil on top of it, it was like the same floor, that the floor made of the dirt floor. And then on top of that, they would put like boxes or whatever it is, just to camouflage it, okay? And it was very unsuspicious. So we got into, 12 of us got into the bunker, and we were covered there for about 3 days. And it was getting so stuffy because there was one duct, and so there was no circulation going in and out. So the air was getting very bad, and it was very difficult to breathe. I mean, we weren't talking about eating or anything. We're just trying to breathe. So after the Polish partisans left that village, Mr. Adolfo Romanowski uncovered it fast, you know, and we were able to go out and get some air and come back to life again. So that was one of the dangers that we faced there. Now, Mr. Romanowski was a very poor person. He didn't have very much. Our main staple was bread and maybe a little bit of milk and potatoes. And a lot of the food was being supplied either directly or by means of giving them the means to purchase it in very small quantities. You see, you had to be very careful, because how could a Mr. Romanowski, that was a poor peasant, all of a sudden have money to buy food for what? He didn't need it before. What, has he got a big family to feed? See, people would get suspicious in the village, and they would say, my God, there's something is wrong. So if they know, if they're suspicious of you, then they start to watch you. So what happened there, we stayed there about 6 or 7 months. And this Mrs. Romanowski, all the clothes that those peasants wore were self-made. They used to make it out of flax or of wool. So it was all homespun and home sewn. Everybody was the same. But Mrs. Romanowski, she has her ego, was in her way. She knew that we could procure for her, through the tubuses, some real material. And she begged us to do that. So we got in contact with the tubuses, and they sent over a piece of material, and she made a skirt. And she went to church, and everybody saw that. And everybody was asking questions. That's why I assume, where in God's name did she get such material? So they were beginning to be suspicious, just from that alone. So one morning, we used to go out, and we had to do our, you know, our sanitary duties. There was a bucket in the corner, and you did it, and you got a little bit of fresh air, and then you went back into the hole. But it was on a rotation basis. One morning, it was a Sunday. Nobody, the Romanowskis, went to church. And there was a neighbor, about maybe 25, 30 feet the house was there was a separation of about that much, and because of this skirt, she was suspicious. So she was snooping around, and one morning she happened. We weren't on our guard, and a number of us was upstairs doing our duty. And she looked through the boarded windows, and she saw us. And that was the end of it. We had to evacuate immediately. And all those brothers, the Monrovsky brothers, had to come, dig up everything, dismantle everything, and bring it back to what it was. So there wouldn't be any proof. Because if the Polish partisans would move back into the village, and if this person would tell them, then the Romanovskis would be killed. That's how dangerous it was. So we got out immediately. I think it was the second night. It happened very fast. And we started to walk at night towards Ostrovets. And we stayed for, I would say, maybe about 10 days or so in the forest. And my Uncle Ben and my Uncle Al, they knew the area and they knew Christian friends, mostly my Uncle Ben. And he would go to them and he would tell them, could you please give me a little food, you know. And he would say, well, it's not only myself, but there are others. And I would appreciate, you know, could you help me? And so they would give him. He wouldn't tell him how many or where we were. He would say somewhere in the forest, okay. And so he made, we did it for about 10 days or so. And meanwhile, he would at night go out and try to make contact with some people that would help him finding another hiding place. So he contacted a Mr. Andrula. Excuse me. This Mr. Andrula, there was Mr. and Miss Andrula, and they had a boy and a girl. And they were poor peasants. I mean, they had a little land. They just ate out a living. And he asked him, he said, look, help us. And if we survive, we'll pay you. We will try to make it worth your while. Mr. Andrula was a very nice person. But, you know, it also helps if you can reward him with something. Because the risks that those people were taking, it was unbelievable. I mean, you practically took your own life in your hands, you know. And he says, well, here, if I'm caught, I'm destroyed. So no matter what was promised and what was said, it wasn't worth it to them. But they did it anyway. So we moved there, and we for a while we stayed in the hay barn. Into the hay, we bore like a hiding place into the hay, you know, like scooped it out like a bunch of chipmunks, and we were hiding in the hay. And then we would walk out and we would walk around on the floor in that building, you know. It kept his hay and his wheat, which was very little. But that is the place and we also dug a bunker in that place. Because we didn't know how long we had to stay. The hay business was permanent. I mean, it was temporary. The bunker was a more permanent place of hiding. The same design like the first one in Dubok. And so we, everybody except my Uncle Al and his wife and his son and my grandmother stayed in Dubok. She didn't come with us because my grandmother went to Mr. Bublevich's mother that lived in Dubok and she hid her. Okay, so there was a number of us that separated, but the biggest number was in that hayloft in the barn, in that building, but Mr. Andrula. And there we stayed until the Russians liberated that part of Poland.
What was your physical condition during this hiding period?
Well, the physical conditions was that we had lice and we had fleas, and that we were so undernourished, and it was just hiding like a rat in some hole.
But you were an undernourished child. Yes. At that time.
Yes.
How did you, were you strong enough to do things?
Oh, yes, yes.
Did you have been
No.
helped by somebody?
No. I was strong enough. I was just very skinny. I mean, you could count my ribs, you know. I was very skinny. I didn't have an ounce of fat on me. It was just, you know, very, very skinny, undernourished, you know. But I was relatively healthy. I mean, I ate, I drank clean water. I had potatoes and bread, maybe once in a while a piece of butter, a piece of cheese, you know, which was a luxury. And but the rest of it, it was just, you know, it just went day by day. It was just like the whole world caved in on you, you know, and you were just there existing and hoping maybe you're going to survive, you know, waiting for a miracle. So one was not conscious about I want this food or that food. It was a matter of a little food and just to be safe, not to be discovered. The main issue was not to be discovered, not to be found out. So I remember being on the hayloft up high. I remember a sunny day, and the wheat was growing in the field, and I saw two airplanes going by very fast, very low. Now, I didn't know that they were Russian planes, but later on I found out they were Russian planes. Even though I think I saw the red star, you know, because they were so close, and they were moving one next to the other. But I didn't believe it, you know. So later on I found out they were Russian planes, because after a while the Russians started to go through. They never stopped. They just kept on going. So Mr. Andrulli came and says, the Germans are running away, the Russians are coming, and we're going to be free. It was a wonderful feeling. And so that was the way it happened. But we couldn't just all of a sudden appear, here we are. We had to be very careful how we exited that place. We had to exit in such a way that nobody knew we ever were there. Because if they knew we were there, he would be ostracized by his Polish friends, or by his, not friends, by his Polish Polish people, the neighbors. A lot of them would hold it against him. The same thing was happening with Mr. Romanovsky. We had to do it in such a way that nobody would know. Otherwise, they would call Jew lovers, and they would be persecuted, okay, by the Polish people, by their neighbors. So it was a very touchy operation. So we stayed there we didn't just leave right away. We stayed there maybe about another 5 or 7 days. And then when everything quieted down, we snuck out in the evening very quietly, and we started to walk towards Ostrovets, where my parents lived and had their bakery and had a house. And this is how it happened. We came to Ostrovets, and I remember when some of the people in Ostrovets saw me, some of the women crossed themselves because they looked like hell, like, you know, so skinny, you know, so emaciated, you know, and they were just surprised, you know. So that is how we came to Ostrovets, back to Ostrovets. Yeah.
Whom did you find in Ostrovets from your family?
There were no Jews in Ostrovets when we came there. Of course, the people that, the Christian people that were occupying the Jewish homes were there. They were very surprised to see me, and they were surprised to see us too, because that means they would lose my father's house and my grandmother's house. Okay, but that was not the issue. I was not interested in my father's house. I didn't care what happens to my father's house. I didn't care hell about it. But they were concerned. Okay, and they were surprised to see us.
We will stop now and go to the next step. This is tape number 6. I am interviewing Mr. Maurice Gordon. And you were talking about post-liberation.
Yes.
What happened to you after the liberation? Where did you go?
Okay. When we came from the last hiding place where we were liberated by the Russians to Ostrovets, back to the place where I was born and sort of raised to for a little while, stay there till occupied by the Russians and Germans and so forth. We went back into my grandmother's house, and the people that lived there moved to another part of the house. We just didn't tell them to exit and go get the hell out of there. You know, we just let them stay there. Okay, we just occupied one part of the house. And then there was talk that there were Polish partisans, steel gangs of them, running around in the countryside, and they were very dangerous to the Russians and to the Jews. The Germans were out. Okay. They were hoping that they were going to fight the Russians and to have their own country. You know, big shots. Anyway, but they would kill Jews. Without question, said if you were in their way, if they came across, they would shoot you. That's all. So we kind of were afraid of that, but you know, it was, we were thinking, well, maybe it's not exactly so. So in a short period of time, in another town not far away from us, it was Mikhailishik, there was a man and a woman that were married, and they were killed by the Polish partisans, and this lady's brother was living with us in Ostrovets, in my grandmother's house. Berke Klor is his name. Boris or Bernie would be probably Klor. He's still alive. He lives in Florida now. So his sister and her husband were killed by the Polish partisans. So we knew right away there is no place for us. We got to get out. Because it was a small town. There weren't too many Russian soldiers, you know. It was at night, you know, the Polish partisans could sneak in. And if they knew there was a Jew, they would kill him. So when I say decided, I was only a child. My relatives decided that we would go to Vilna, because my mother's brother was there. My uncle Al, okay, Wittenberg, was there with his family. And Mr. Levine was there. And Mr. Levine's brother and his wife and his daughter that survived were also there. They went back to Vilna, okay. So we knew that Vilna is a big city. It has a lot of, there are a lot of Russian soldiers. There's, it's like a government of Russia, you know. We would be safer there. So that's what we did. We just abandoned and we took our few things that we had and we got on a horse and wagon and we drove to Vilna. Now the logistics, all of this was done with the Tubises, you know, these Polish friends of ours. So when we came to Vilna, we looked around, and my family looked around, you know, and they saw there was no future for us there, that we must get out of there by whatever means. And Mr. Tubis's family saw no future for them either, because it was known that they're Jew lovers. And if you're a Jew lover, you know, sooner or later they're going to get you. Somebody was going to get you. So they had to leave their home, their farm. They had a lot of land. They had horses and they had cows and they had pigs. And they were, if you were talking about, in compared to other peasants, they were wealthy. They had a mill for grinding wheat. And they packed up their belongings to the extent that they could take with them, you know, a couple of horses, a couple of cows, you know, certain belongings and so forth. And they went with us from Vilna by train. We arranged, I don't know how it was arranged, but it was arranged by either bribing or paying of the Russian authorities that we got on the train. And we went from Vilna, we went to Lodz. And when we came to Lodz, Lodz was an awful place. It was a bummed out place. Lodz had a huge ghetto. I was there, you know, later on I walked into there. It was all bummed out. It was horrible. But anyway, the place where we stayed in Lodz was a bummed out building, a burned out building. And it was very bad. I mean, and the Tubises brought their few cows and horses with them, and they kept them in another burned out building, and they were stolen. You know, some bandits stole it, you know. So it was very disheartening. I felt very bad for them. And so they were all. But that's the way it is. They stole it. So we decided to get out of Poland. We wanted to go towards the Americans. So we went from Lodz to Szczecin. Szczecin is a city that is bordering with East Germany, with the River Oder. So when you cross the River Oder and you travel for a little while, you are in East Germany.
Did the Tobis escape with you at that time?
No, they stayed in Poland. They decided, you see, at that time, the Russians were telling the Poles that they are going to have their own identity, their own democratic government, their own republic or whatever. They'll be left alone, okay? They were telling them that, which was not true. It was never meant to be. So they had hopes that they will be in their own country. So they settled in Poland, and we left. That is where we separated. At least in Poland, people didn't know them, so they were relatively safe. They couldn't be called Jew lovers. Okay. So also the Romanovskis came to Poland because they had to escape the place because they were found out that they were hiding Jews. And they were persecuted. They were called Jew lovers and all kinds of stuff. And their life was miserable, so they had to leave. And they came to Poland also. So we stayed in Szczecin for a very short time. That's my relatives and I and my grandmother. And somebody made contact with Russian soldiers that were driving trucks from Szczecin to Berlin. And whatever was negotiated, I don't know, whether vodka or whether something, whatever, okay? The fact remains that they said, okay, we'll take you. They put us on a truck. They covered us and with a tarpaulin, you know, a tarpaulin truck. And we went towards the German border that was bordering between Poland and Germany, you know, so forth, with the Russians. And when we came to checkpoint, I remember it was nighttime. And the Russian soldiers covered us up with a tarpaulin and told us to be quiet. And I could hear them talk to the Russian soldiers that was guarding the checkpoint, you know, the barrier to open or close to let you through. You know. And they said, like, what's going on, small talk, and where are you going? So we're going to Berlin. And they took out a bottle of vodka and they had a drink together and they talked for a little while and said, go ahead. And that was all of it. They never looked or nothing. Now, I don't know if they looked and they found us what our fate would be. I don't know. But the fact is they never looked, they didn't care, they just were satisfied with the vodka. And so we came at night to Berlin, to a place called, we got off in Berlin, they let us off, but we somehow knew, my relatives knew that there is a place in Berlin where they would receive Jews. And the place was called Oranienburgstrasse. There was a bombed out building, and a lot of Jews would be gathered up there by Jewish organizations. They were gathered, kept there for a little while till they would find out where they could send them, how they could help them. And we were fed by the Jewish organization.
Did you ever find out where did the fiscal means, the money come from to bribe Russians, to buy food, to
from
arrange
us?
Your...
From
yes,
us.
For you.
Well, that was, you see, when we were liberated, there were certain monies that were hidden that we uncovered it, okay? And also, the Tubises, they were wealthy, they were well off. They had monies and they sold off their cattle and so forth, whatever they could sell off. So there was monies. Mainly the basic trading with the Russians was vodka, okay? And the Tubises used to make their own vodka, okay? They had their own machinery, whatever they were called, stills. They used to make their own vodka. It was very good vodka. But there were means of material things that were available to us because my uncles also would do some trading stuff like this. They could earn a little bit of money, and we didn't need very much, you see. We only needed is enough to eat because the places where we lived was bombed out buildings. It was rent-free, okay? It was nothing to look upon, you know? So all we needed is enough food to eat and enough money to have in case we needed to bribe somebody or to buy something to escape. So it was not like you were talking about a lot of money. You know, it was small amounts.
So now we were in Berlin.
Now we were in Berlin, and we were received in Oranienburgstrasse. And I think the money to support us there came from the Americans. It was called, it was a Jewish organization, I don't remember, but the means of support came from the Jewish organization. So we're being fed there and held there until a time came, very shortly, we weren't there very long, maybe 10 days or something like this yet, that somebody found out from Russian officers, there were Jewish Russian officers that somebody was in contact with, okay? I mean, those guys, they're just, they were not asleep on their feet. They were very alert, and they were looking around, you know, for danger, and they were trying to make contact and find out ahead of time whether what is going on. And the Russian officers told him, you better get out of there, because and such a night, they're going to come around you, I'll put you in trucks and take you back to Russia. So we gathered up our belongings, and we got on the U-Bahn. It was like a train, you know, like in New York, the underground trains. They had an overground. They had on top, and there was overground. And we went to Vincennes. We wound up in Vincennes. Vincennes is the place where, in 1942, I believe in January, I remember the date, January 20, because I came across it. 1942, they had the conference to finally get rid of the Jews, the final solution, okay? So that is where we wound up, in one of the buildings. Now, I don't know whether it was the exact buildings where they had them, but it was one of the, well, there were beautiful, beautiful villas. I mean, tremendous, beautiful, beautiful buildings, huge buildings. And we stayed there for a short time till the American authorities, the military authorities, came to us. Probably they were being approached by the Jewish organization to help us, and they put us in trucks, and they took us to Schlachtensee, which was a German army barracks. Okay, and we stayed in Schlachtensee. As a matter of fact, in Schlachtensee, in 46, I became bar mitzvah, and this, to best of my knowledge, is, I think I was the only Jewish boy after the war in Berlin that became bar mitzvah. Now, maybe there was somebody else, but I doubt it very much. This bar mitzvah was being made possible by American Jews that were serving in the army that came to the camps, you know, to visit. Also, there was an American chaplain. He was a captain by the name of Shubov, Rabbi Shubov. He was from Boston. I know that. I know that he was from Boston. I never saw him again. Okay. He was instrumental in having to enable that for me to become bar mitzvah. Okay, and I have a picture of that. So in Schlachtensee, I became bar mitzvah, and it was a big deal. I mean, everybody was so happy, and the whole camp, the hundreds of people were involved, you know, and took part. Participated in that, you know.
Who taught you your Haftarah?
My Haftarah was taught by a Jew, and I cannot remember his name, but I will point out his face on the picture. He taught me the Haftarah. And now let me tell you, I was so emotionally involved in it that I got sick to my stomach with cramps. And, you know, I doubled over from the emotions when I was singing the Haftarah, you know, and saying my prayers. So it was a big deal, you know. It was good. I think it was good for the whole community. So that is where I became a mitzvah. Now, we stayed there for a time, and sometimes in 46, I think that the latter part of 46, the authorities decided to liquidate this particular DP camp. You know, just take us out from here and take us to another one. And we were again put on trucks, and we were brought into a city called Eschwege. And there was another German Air Force barracks with a landing strip for airplanes and hangars and everything, okay? So we were there till 1948. That was the longest place the longest time that I spent in one time in a DP camp in Germany after the war.
Did you get any education there?
In Eschwege, all the other time, there was a very short time in Schlachtensee that I had Hebrew education, you know. But in Eschwege, there was an assemblance sort of a school. And they just threw together a lot of youngsters, different ages, by finding out their aptitude to whatever they knew, and threw them together, and they taught them a little math, a little history, mostly Jewish history, and a great deal of concentration was on Hebrew. So I was there probably going to school for about a year.
What was the language of teaching there?
It was Hebrew. Yeah. Everything was done in Hebrew. Of course, at the beginning, it was translation from Hebrew, to Jewish, but the core of it was Hebrew. They wanted us to learn Hebrew.
Was there any attempt to get you to Palestine at that time?
Well, there was, at one time, Ben-Gurion came to Eshregeh, and he gave a speech, okay. There were many Jewish organizations, the Zionist organizations and so forth, and they were organizing themselves and preparing themselves to go to Israel. I would say that at least 60% of my friends went to Israel, my buddies, so-called, okay? The rest came to the United States or Canada. Now, it so happened that I went with my grandmother, with my family, and we registered on the Polish quota, so we had to wait 5 years to be called to be admitted into the United States. So I waited from 45 to 1950 in Germany to be admitted to the United States. So, but that was, Eshregeh was the longest time, and then we were moved from Eshregeh to another DP camp. It was Kassel. And we stayed there for a certain length of time. It was nothing, there was no schooling there. It was temporary, very temporary. So there was no schooling there. And then from Kassel, we were moved to Hanau, another DP camp. And the same thing happened. There was no schooling there. It was temporary. And we stayed there for a while. That's Hanau am Main, I think it was. And then from Hanau, we were moved again. I don't know where we were moved. We were just moved to another DP camp, Wildflecken. That was in the mountains. I didn't care for that place. It was. We were thrown together with other nationalities. And some of them were Ukrainians, you know. And I couldn't say for certain, but I know that some of them were those murderers that murdered us during the Nazi times. But they were under assumed names or hiding or, you know. But they were there because at one time there was this man that had a pair of boots, you know, leather boots up to here, like riding boots. They used to shine them up. That was his greatest possession, you know. And he used to love to shine them up and wear them. And during the night, they broke into his little room. He was all by himself. And they beat the hell out of him. They split their head. His head knocked him out. It was bleeding, like awful bleeding. And they stole his boots. And I remember him hollering for help. And I ran up. I jumped out of the bed because we were in an army barracks. And there was a corridor with rooms, you know, on the side. And he was in, like maybe three, four rooms removed from us. And we heard him holler. So I was a little boy and I was a little devil at that time. And I jumped out of bed and opened up the door and I see him standing in the corridor bleeding, you know. So I thought there was a pogrom. So I closed the door again and I knew. And meanwhile, everybody was up, you know. And I told him, and I knew, and I said that this so-and-so, I can't remember his name, is bleeding and he's crying, you know, he's hollering. So there was an axe under the we had an axe, a wood chopping, to chop wood, under the bed, and I ran for the axe, and I was standing near the door, and I said, if anybody opens up and puts, I'm going to hit him with the axe, you know. But anyway, my uncle took my axe away, he opened up the door, and he looked out. And then there was already other people comforting him, you know, and helping and so forth. But that's the kind of element that we were thrown together with. There was no problem when the Jews were separate. So we stayed there for a short time, and then the American consulate called us up, and they told us, first we had to go through the formalities and so forth. They were questioning us if we were communists or whatever, or criminals, you know. Stuff like this, when they were satisfied that we were okay and we had to be healthy. We couldn't have any TB or anything like this. So they wouldn't let you in at that time. Now they're letting in everybody, okay? A bunch of druggies. But at any rate, at that time, that was the law. And they called us, they told us that we are ready to be transported to the United States. So they took us by train from there They took us to a train, and by train we went from Wilfleggen to Hamburg, and we stayed in a building in Hamburg for several days till we were finally embarked on the boat.
Do you remember the name of the boat?
No, I don't remember the name of the boat.
Did you have an affidavit, or did you come on a general entrance permit?
As I said, we registered under the Polish quota. So this was when my number came up. That is how we entered. Okay, and we entered, we came to the United States, we came to New York. We didn't go to Ellis Island. We came to New York, and we were received by a Jewish organization, and we were brought to a hotel on Broadway someplace. And I stayed there for a short time. And then we went to Albany, because at that time in Albany, my Uncle Al and his family were there already. They came ahead of us. So my grandmother, I, and my Uncle Ben, we went to Albany from there. Yeah, that is how I came to the United States.
Did you continue education in the United States?
I continued education. When I came to the United States, I was registered into a... I went to a high school, the first year of high school I was admitted to, because they sort of gave me a little test and they figured that I could handle it. So I went to the Philip Schuyler High School in Albany, and for a short time, and I used to go during daytime, I used to go to school, and the nighttime I used to go to work, and my work was very, very hard. I worked in I washed dishes, okay, in a restaurant, and it was very hard work, very hot in the summertime, sweating and filthy, you know, and all this stuff. And later on, I started to work in a printery where they print stuff. So until I learned a little bit how to use the machinery in the printery, my job was to clean the rolls with the inks, you know, prepare it for a different batch with different inks. So I was always filthy with inks, with different types of ink on my face, on my hands, on my body, my clothes. I would just wear dungarees and stuff like this. And it was very labor-intensive work, for which I was paid maybe like 30 cents an hour. Okay.
Have you been called up to the U.S. Army later?
Yes, in 1953, I got a letter from President Harry Truman. God bless his soul. Well, anyway, that I am to be inducted in the service of the United States, and for which I went. And I didn't know at that time. Nobody told me. I didn't have to go, because I was the only survivor of my whole entire family. And I didn't have to go. I didn't know about it. Nobody told me. And I went. But I came through it fine.
Where did you serve?
I served in Germany. I went back to Germany.
In which branch of the army?
In ordnance. Yeah.
And where did they send you in Germany?
I was stationed, most of my time was stationed in Schwabach near Nuremberg. Yeah.
Did the Germans around you knew that you are Jewish American or American Jewish?
In Germany?
Yes.
God, I don't even recall. I had some German friends. I made German friends. I got along with them. Very cordial. I have never experienced any kind of, animosity towards me. Not at that time. As a matter of fact, you know, if I could go back a little bit, that in Poland after the war, I was in grave danger. After I was liberated, I was in grave danger because I was a Jew. As soon as I came into Germany, I felt free. That stopped. There was no more this killing or shooting or Jude or verfluchte Jude or whatever. That stopped. It is like overnight it stopped. It's amazing, the control.
How did you find your American comrades in the army?
I got along with them. I got along with them. I had no problem. I was a good soldier. I got along with them very well. Yeah.
Did they know that you are Jewish and a refugee?
This subject really never came up. But they knew that I was Jewish. Not all of them. And they knew that I was foreign, because I had this awful dialect. The speech, you know, was different. It probably still is. Okay. So they knew that I was foreign. As far, nobody ever asked me if I was Jewish. My close friends knew that I was Jewish. For some time, when I was in basic training in Aberlin Proving Grounds in Maryland, I worked for the Jewish chaplain. I was his assistant. So I did a lot. I helped him a lot. And his name was Lavazar. He was a major. I don't know what happened to him. It was a long time ago since I saw him. He was very nice to me.
Did you get married?
Yes. I got married in 1964.
How did you meet your wife?
I met my wife through a friend, a Christian friend that I worked with. And one evening he says, I would like you to meet my wife's sister. My wife is Christian. And I said, okay. So I went over to the house, and there she was. And she was at that time teaching at Long Island. And I said to myself, oh, my God, a city girl, you know, phew, that's too much for me, you know. I didn't know, you know, that she was really not way out there. She was just an ordinary person, you know. But to me, a city girl was very scary, you know. I was not used to that type of life. So I just made a note to myself, oh, my God, a city girl. But when I got to know her, she was a wonderful, wonderful person. I fell in love with her. And we got married. We got married in 1964, January 25, 1964. We got married. And then we had two sons. One was born in April 28, 1965. And one was born in February 23, 1967.
The fact that your wife is Gentile,
yes,
did it influence you in telling her or not telling her your background and your Holocaust experiences?
Oh, yes. When I met her, I talked about it. I talked about it, not in to the extent or to degree or to expressing myself, because I didn't think through at that time to that depth, you know. I just told her basically what happened to me, you know. I did not go into questions that deep of why, you know. My search started, it was starting a long time ago, but I would stop myself. I wouldn't go into that deeply, okay, because it was bothering me. It was hurting me too much. I couldn't be objective. I couldn't detach myself. It was clouded, you know, and I was angry. So I told her basically events, how it happened, what happened, and we left it there. She knew about my background. Yes, she knew more than anybody else that was not in my family.
Did your attitude toward her, was your attitude influenced by your Holocaust experience, or was her attitude toward you influenced by your Holocaust experience?
Well, this is something that is very important for me to express that.
If so, we will stop now and go to the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape number 7. I'm interviewing Mr. Morris Gordon. You started to talk about interaction between yourself and your Gentile wife concerning the Holocaust.
Yeah. Well, when I met her, soon after, we took an interest in each other, and I told her my background. I expressed to her my feelings, my deep feelings at the time, my concerns, the way I knew it. I told her what happened to me and to my family. She was very understanding and very compassionate. I could feel the radiating from her, you know. I could tell right away when I talked to her the first time that she is a person of great understanding and deep understanding and very intelligent. I also knew that she was not a prejudiced person just by knowing her and talking to her. I had that feeling that she doesn't even know what prejudice is, you know. When I think of Catholics, okay, I think of her, if there is such a thing as a true Catholic, you know, that according to the teachings of Christ, should love your neighbor and forgive them, those that do you harm, well, that would be my assumption of her, that she, in a way, is a true Catholic. She was a teacher by training. She taught for a while. And then when we met and got married and we had children soon after, she stopped teaching and she was a mother to our children. She used to substitute from time to time, but her main job was to raise our children. And my children, because of her, because I was working all the time, and when I wasn't working, I was tired, you know, and I had so many chores. So most of her upbringing, most of the care of the children, most of them, all of it, and the influence that my children had was from her. And she is the one that taught them Judaism, that told them, read them stories about Purim, about the story of Esther, about Passover, about the Jews in Egypt. She's the one that made the Seder. And she's also the one that had a Christmas tree, because there was, in my mind, there was no difference. She was, in my mind, in the way I felt about it, a genuine, good person, for which I have a great deal of respect for her. And she has influenced my children. She has taught them to be what they are now. She has taught them to contribute to the world, to this world we call Earth. And by her influence, they will be good people and they will do good things for themselves and for humanity. Now, she also had a great influence on me. She sort of kept me from becoming a real, true cynic, you know. She kept me in balance. And she was my friend. And she was always there for me when I needed her. And for that, I'm very grateful to her.
How do you bring up your children, your sons, Jews? Well, Jewish or non-Jewish?
We decided to set an example by what we do. And we told them about, in general, about religion. We said that you can become whatever you want to become. When you grow up to be old enough, you can choose whatever you want to be. My older son chose Judaism. He married a Jewish girl. And he went to Hebrew school, to a rabbi, and he studied Hebrew and so forth. And he's very interested. My youngest son has no religion. He has all kinds of friends. He has no problem with that. Now, my older son is a medical doctor, and my younger son, he's 30, my younger son. He is in music. He is very, very talented. His major instrument is piano, his minor is clarinet, and he can play any instrument that he wants to. He is now finishing his third master's an AMD in music. So he's also teaching at University of Mississippi right now, Old Miss, and for which they give him a stipend he can take all the courses he wants and so forth. I feel that my wife has done a wonderful job. Now, the reason, you see, when my children were young, I had a choice to tell them what happened to me as a Jew during the Nazi period, during the Holocaust. I chose not to tell him very much. I told him very little. And my way of thinking, whether I'm right or wrong, I don't know, but this is what I want to do, is that I did not want to influence them when they were young, like the Polish children were influenced by their mother, like Yitzhak Shamir once said, while they were sucking on the mother's breast drinking the milk. They were right there introduced to anti-Semitism. Right there. It is like anti-Semitism started from the time they were born, and then it was continued when they grew up, when they went to the catechism. They were taught about how Jesus was killed, that we were accused of crucifying Jesus. We were called Christ killers, and we were money grabbers, and that all was coming, in my opinion, from my observation, through the church. The church in my part of Poland had tremendous power for evil and for good. And for whatever reason, and the reason I think to me now is clear, it has been clear for a long time, I've been pondering this why. They chose to indoctrinate their followers with that type of thinking, to hate the Jews, is because they needed a scapegoat to blame the Jews for all the evils that happened in the world, because they figured that we were responsible of killing Christ. And this followed us for probably 1600 years through all the countries of the diaspora. We were always a minority. Whenever something went bad, we were the evil people, we were the devils, we were the ones that were going to hell, and our souls had to be rescued and purified, and we would have to become Christians, like in the Spanish Inquisition, Torquemada, that either you become a Christian, or you're being expelled, or you're being killed, or burned to the stake, or whatever. And even if you became a Christian and you were practicing Judaism secretly, they were called Moranos, which means pigs, you know. So we were always blamed for things that we have never done. We were a convenient ethnic group scattered all over the world to take on the blame for everything that happened, whether it was economically, whether it was politically, whether it was some plague. You had to have an excuse to blame somebody what happened to them. And the Jews were expected to take it. And through time, even I would probably think that if the Poles would have a chance right now, they would do it all over again. Now, this is my opinion. I may be wrong. But if history is a teacher, then I don't think I'm wrong. As a matter of fact, they did it during the time of Gomulka, when he was the president of Poland. They massacred a bunch of Jews because a child was lost for a short time, and they accused the Jews of murdering the child and using his blood to bake matzos, you know, like the story goes from so many hundreds of years ago. So I didn't want my children to be exposed to such hatred, to such venom coming from me and saying to them, now this is what Christians have done to me and to my people for generations and generations and generations. I wanted them to have a good education, and both of them went to the best school in the United States. That's Amherst College. This is a very, very reputable school. It's very hard to get into it. And they got a very good liberal arts education. So I figured that when they reach that stage, at some point in time, I will sit down and tell them my story. So they would have the tools, the intellectual tools, to be able to reason and to have background to understand and not hate just for hate's sake itself. So they would know the injustices that were perpetrated to us and understand the reasons why and go on with their life so they wouldn't be poisoned and do harm to themselves and to other people. Mostly, it is, well, to themselves is the most important thing, because when one hates, it eats one person up. It doesn't do any good to hate anybody. You have to understand. And if without understanding or knowledge, you will hate, it will destroy their lives. It will destroy their future. It would be hell for them, because hate is not good. And that is why I chose. I chose not to tell them early on, because I didn't want to happen to them what was happening to those little boys and those little girls that were Christians. Because everybody that's born is innocent. It takes a lot of stories, a lot of teaching from their parents to come to that point of hate. You transfer it from father and mother to your children. Or else, where did they get it from? Where did they get it from? Out of thin air? This is why I didn't tell my children for a very long time, till they were grown and they could have the capacity to understand.
When did that time come?
The time came after they graduated from... Actually, the time came after they graduated from Amherst, and my son went to medical school, and from time to time I would talk to them. You know, not to that extent, but little pieces, you know. Just sit down and talk to them. And so far, I think I've done a good job, because they do not hate anybody. And I think that even though my wife tells me, she says, that the children of the Holocaust survivors, which means I'm a Holocaust survivor, and my children, are also suffering, you suffering. It is like a carryover. And I have discussions with her about that. And I feel bad if that is the case, if my children, for some reason, are suffering or feeling my pain, which, of course, every parent wants to prevent that from happening. But I think, in the long run, I think I've done the right thing. And I think that if they are suffering, at least they are capable of understanding at the time when they were able to reason, not when they were little children. Now, maybe if I told them when they were small, no harm would have come, and maybe they wouldn't hate anybody for what was done to the Jewish people. But that is the decision I took, and that is what I did.
I would like to use the rest of the time on this tape to show the pictures that you choose, okay, because they are important for you.
Yes.
So, meanwhile, thank you for your effort.
You're welcome.
And we will stop for a moment and continue with the tapes.
Okay. On the left side, there's a picture of my mother, circa 1902. And on the right side, that is I, in Berlin in 1946.
What is the full name of your mother?
Ita Fager, Gordon, maiden name Wittenberg. This is a picture of my mother, circa 1902. Her name is Ita Fager, Gordon.
Who took the picture and where?
I think this picture was taken in Vilnius. I think so.
Is it a professional picture?
Yes, that was a professional picture, yes. Starting with the left, this is my mother's younger sister. Her name is Badana. And she went to Argentina. She's dead already. And then there is, in the middle sitting, is my grandmother, Nahama Zelda. And the little girl is my aunt Lisa. She's a twin. There's another girl, Dora. And the lady to the right is my mother. and this was taken in 1926. And the background, the buildings on to the right, the tall building, that is the church in this community in Ostrovets. And the building next to it, to the left, is the building that was the rectory where the priest lived. This picture was taken circa 1934. These two girls are twins. They were born in 1916. And the one on the left, her name is Lisa. And the one on the right is Dora. She's the one that married Mr. Bublevich, the Gentile. That was very helpful to us.
How did you get this picture?
These pictures came to us from Argentina, from the younger sister that went to Argentina. She took some pictures with her when she went. That is how I obtained the pictures. The rest of the pictures were destroyed. This picture was taken circa 1929. This is the twin sisters, Lisa and Dora. Lisa is to the left and Dora is to the right. And in the middle is my grandmother, Nahama Zelda.
Where was the picture taken?
This, I think, was probably taken in Vilnius, because it's a professional picture. This picture is taken circa 1937. This is my aunt Dora, and I am sitting in back of her on the bicycle. That is Morris Gordon, that is I. And the background is my grandmother's house.
Is this an original picture?
This is an original picture, yes.
Taken in?
Taken in Ostrovets. I don't know the date of the picture, but these are our Polish friends. These are the two Tubises girls. The one on the left is called Pela, and the one on the right is Mania. Now they're both dead.
The time they hid you or arranged for your hiding, were they actually there too?
Yes.
And the house, it is...
That's their house in the village where they lived. This picture was taken in Schlachtensee in Berlin in 1946. That was my bar mitzvah picture. Now, I am right in the middle, and I remember the rabbi in the United States Army uniform on the right. You can see him, his name is Rabbi Shuboff. He was a chaplain in the Army, United States Army. He was a captain. He originally came from Boston. He was instrumental in arranging for my bar mitzvah, you know, for the food and so forth. And all the other people are, some of them are Americans that worked to help the Jews in the camps, volunteers, and some of them are just Jews in the camp.
Looking
also, the one next to the right of me is the person that taught me the Torah, and I cannot remember his name.
Looking at the picture of your bar mitzvah, is there any change in your religious beliefs between that time and today?
Well, I would say it sum it up this way. I've never had a conflict with God. My conflict was with people.
Do you still believe in Judaism?
Of course, yes, I believe in Judaism as a Jew. I'm very proud. I wouldn't change it for the world, no matter what the cost. This picture was taken in Eschwege in 1946, and I am in the top left corner, and the rest of the people are my friends and sort of leaders.
And what occasion was the picture taken?
I don't know. It was just a gathering, you know, just a gathering of nothing special, but just took a group picture. Maybe it was at the beginning or at an end of football, soccer game or something like that.
Do you know who took the picture?
Oh, no, I don't remember that. It was somebody. This is my Uncle Ben, Benjamin Wittenberg. He is my mother's sister. He is the one that was so vitally instrumental because he had so many Polish friends that that helped us because of his relationship with them, and that's why we're alive. This is Mr. Levine. I believe the picture, he was born circa 1900. He was very kind to me. He's related to me by marriage. He's the one that took me out of Vilna ghetto. And he is the one that had many Christian friends in the Vilna, in the surrounding area of Vilna. And he was very also instrumental in saving us because of his Christian contacts and friends. This picture was taken June 1991. This is when my older son Stephen was married. And Stephen is on the left side, my wife is next, and I am next to the right, and my younger son Andrew is the last to the right.
What is your wife's name?
Adrian. This picture was taken in June 91. This is my son's wedding. My son is to the left. Next to him is his bride. And next to her is my wife, Adrian. And next to my wife am I, myself, and I.
What is the bride's name?
Allison. This is my grandson, Stephen's son. Jason is his name. He's about a year old or thereabouts. This was taken in December 1990. That's in my house. And this is my wife, Adrienne, and my beautiful girl that I love very much.
Where was the picture taken?
In my house, in my living room, in Belmar.